I'm really excited about the future of the Pistons. I'm just, you know, I'm really excited about everything. I just want to see where everything's going to go, you know. It's just so much mystery.
Yeah. It's good, though. It's exciting for the team. I mean, I'm not in Detroit, but I'm happy for the city that they're excited about the team, though.
Right.
My thing is that Stan Van Gundy can't keep a team together for a couple days before he's already trading people and shipping people out. Like 15 minutes before we get on air, he's over here making trades and shit. It's unbelievable. Can't keep up with the guy. You're cutting out, Elda.
I don't think anybody can look really smart to them.
Hello.
Yeah, you guys good?
Yeah. Elder's over there cutting out, man. We barely hear a word or two.
Oh, can you hear me? Oh, I'm up there. Can you hear me better?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I have a phone to be, like, I don't know what it is. I'm going to have to send it back. This LG3 be tripping sometimes.
Right. Yeah, I actually got a 2, so I understand totally.
Yeah, I don't get it. It's like, it's supposed to be this really good phone, but then sometimes people be like, I don't hear you. So I got to put on speaker, then they're like, I hear you perfect. So it's crazy.
Yeah, it's really weird that way.
Man, I'm going to send it back, though. That's what I'm going to choose.
Right.
So I don't think any of you guys were losing sleep over Quincy Miller, right? Nobody here? Anybody?
That's Mike Campbell boy.
Yeah, that's Mike Campbell boy. Absolutely. That's Mike Campbell boy. Sure is.
What's going on, man?
We're gonna make sure he don't have a suicide watch going on. That's his boy.
That's his guy.
No, go ahead.
I was real bad for Quincy Miller, man. It was just like, man. Like, he was going to be his chance to, like, show if he had anything, if he could really be an NBA player. It's just all these injuries just happened at the wrong time, you know. It's kind of sad, you know. I kind of hate it for him. I really do, because he had, I mean, it's a slot open, and you never know, you know. It's just, you don't know.
You know, the only thing good about it, for him, I'm just talking about for him. Is he still young? Mm-hmm. Like 22, mm-hmm. 23, so he's still young to kind of really get himself together. And I heard he had a really good off season. Just reading the reports about, you know, putting that weight, muscle, you know, really having strong workouts. But, you know what I mean? Teams can't keep you around. You're going to be out for like 4 to 6 weeks and you can't play. And, you know, they're trying to get their teams together and know what talent they have and everything like that. So, you know, I just feel like Pistons are in playoff mode. I don't think they're in this, and I said it before the draft, and I said now, I don't think they're in this whole player development mode, and if a guy has to blossom, I mean, if a guy gets better, a guy gets better, I get that. They're sitting around like, oh, in 3 years, you know, such and such is going to be a contributor. I don't think they're in that mode. I think they're in this, like, we're ready to win now, and the moves they're putting in place are showing that we're in win now mode. We're not just waiting. So Quincy Miller just kind of got caught.
Yep.
In between that, you know, getting to the place. Like, the Pistons are in this, you know, we build it for the future and we see all this type of stuff, I think he'd be fine. But when you win this, like, we trying to win now, we don't got 3 years to see what a player can be, I think it's hard to, you know, be having to sit out 4 to 6 weeks, you know?
Yeah, I
agree. And
I see as soon as they were announcing Reggie Bullock, you know, they had a press conference for him. I'm like, these guys are going to be cut really soon here. I don't think I've seen Quincy Miller coming, but I mean, I just kind of figured, you know, you got to put two and two together. I mean, they're not going to have Reggie Bullock and Quincy Miller off the bench. I mean, they get, that's too many project guys for one position.
Yeah,
second. Right.
Yeah.
And
you're
and,
right.
And Reggie is known for that defense. Like, he's known for, like, kind of being like a – I'm talking even back in with Carolina. He's known for being, like, a little, like, a tough defender. So –
yep.
So, I think – I mean, even if he – while he makes the team, he's going to make it on his three-point shooting and his ability to defend in the perimeter. Quincy Miller is not a defender. You know, he's always just this guy who was, like, highly recruited out of high school. But, you know, through injuries, he's always dealt with injuries. He dealt with injuries in high school, and he's dealt with injuries in college. So that's just like his – it's becoming his M.O. So a team not going to stick around forever and just keep on waiting, waiting, waiting. So,
hey, you're right. You know that Baylor team? Like, that Baylor team had a bunch of those, like, high-profile high school guys. And I followed them because, you know, when you see the footage of, like, when they're in high school, you see Quincy Miller and PJ3, like, I was really high on PJ3. I thought he was going to be, like, spectacular because, like, those high school kids, when you see him, you was like, Jesus, this guy is 6'11 with candles and he can shoot and he's athletic and he's long. And it's like, I was really high on him. And then he got the Baylor and that Baylor Instinct thing came up on him. And it was like, you could see it. Like, he never really accepted himself, but, like, I'm the man and I can do it. And it kind of got a profile on him. Like, he's not a go-to guy. You know, he's just a secondary guy. And
I remember him this year. I'm talking about this year for OKC. He started off, like, really hot. Like, if you go back and look at his, like, his game chat, I mean, I'm talking about early in the season, like, the first 10 games.
Oh, yeah. When KD was out, oh, he was balling. He was balling.
And then he just disappeared. Then he just... Then I would read reports about, they were saying stuff like he didn't want to defend and he was just reading, like, little things and, you know, he seemed like he banked off and the coaching staff wasn't really behind him and they feel like he, you know, all the same stuff. And I just feel like, that's what I'm trying to say. Like, I was really, like, on him, too. Like, I remember that draft. There was, like, certain players who I was just high on. I was high on Jared Sullender. I was high on, because I wasn't even thinking Drummond would be available. But I was high on Jared Sullender. I was high on Jones. And and then it was Curry, Jones, the Curry. And those were, like, my three. So I was like, but man, I'm really glad we didn't pick him. Because I think I'd be disappointed. I just think I would be real disappointed in him if we had picked him. You see the player he's, you know, he's in a good team. I'm not saying Scott Brooks is like the greatest coach ever, but he was in a good system with good players. And it just seemed like, unless he just needs a new atmosphere and he just maybe one of the players who will get it one day, he just seems like, I don't know, like he could be out the league in a couple of years. That's how I feel, like he could be out the league in a couple of years.
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree. Dang, not to be on the other subject with Pistons, but that was just an interesting conversation. Sorry, I didn't watch that. Whatever. But yeah, man, like, I agree. And I kind of feel like that about Quincy Miller. Like, those guys just never, like, blew their potential. But back to the Pistons, man, like, the KCP thing, let's talk about it. Let's get it out here. Let's do it now.
Hold on. Let's talk about our newest Piston, man. We got a new Piston, dude. We got a new Piston. As of 7:45, we got a new Piston. Hasn't even been a half hour in. You guys.
Point guard, so.
Huh?
Oh, you got 4 point guards. So you're probably gonna make another move.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so too. I think Spencer's time is ticking. He didn't have a great summer league showing. He's not showing that his size is really helping any when defending. Matter of fact, he's getting guys blowing right past him just off the dribble. So I don't know. I think Spencer's time's coming. His shot wasn't falling either. I don't know. I'm not you know, he's a second-round draft pick, so I just got to take it for what it is. You know, not every second-round draft pick is going to become a star, you know. So, I mean, anybody that's having high expectations for him is just, you know, you just got to really take it for granted when it's second-round draft picks, in my opinion. So I don't mind if he gets moved, in my opinion. I don't mind. I like Steve Blake. I think Steve Blake's a quality point guard. Definitely a three-point shooter. Definitely a three-point shooter. I think that's what we've been missing from the point guard spot since Jennings went down and DJ got traded, is that three-point shooting from that one position. So I think he brings a little bit of that, too.
Yeah, you can't rule out the fact that Brandon Jennings still could be traded.
Yep.
Definitely.
Yeah, he can still get traded. I wonder, like, does anybody know, like, what's the regulation on trading injured players? Like, what is the, anybody know what that is? Like, can you trade injured players right now?
You can trade an injured player as long as the other team, they know of the injury, and they're, like, as long as they know of the condition and everything, it doesn't matter. So, if they say they want to take them on, as like, if, Portland, I'm just saying, Portland said we want to take him on, and we understand that, you know, we have injuries, as long as nothing's hidden, like, as long as his recovery process is not hidden, as long as they know where he's at, it's up to them. You know, they could take on who they want to take on in the trade of an injured player.
Realistically, though, what 29 teams do you think would take a Brandon Jennings recovering from an Achilles heel injury?
A tanking team? Other than that, nobody? Yeah,
maybe New York, definitely.
New York. I would think the same thing. New York would take him right now. They would. I think they would,
What would they give up?
That's
the question. That's the question. What would they give up?
Exactly. That would be a question for us. Like,
yeah, I don't like a Raymond Felton. I don't know who they got.
I don't know. And no Layton Galloway. No, please. No Layton Galloway. I don't want any of those guys.
Yeah, y'all want Lakes and Galloway? He's not that much better than KCP. Here we go.
No. I want to
put this out real quick about Spencer, though. His thing, I heard Mike say, you know, he's a second round, but if you really look at before the injury, you know, Spencer had an ATL, Spencer really was graded as, like, first round talent.
Oh, he was a first round pick.
He was considered. So if you look at some, if you can find the older mocks and old write ups, he was like considered like maybe I want to say like mid first round, so probably about I want to say about 17 to about 24. He was considered like a first round pick. So I think he's still for the idea of getting the first round guy in the second round, but he's just not translating. But in college, Spencer was more of a scoring guard. He was a point guard, but he was scoring. He was shooting. I think he comes here to Detroit, and they're trying to make him this point guard. And I hate when people do that. I hate when you draft scoring point guards in college, guys who've been scorers their whole life. Then they get to the NBA, and all of a sudden you want them to be this passer point guard. He's not that kind of guy. He's a 6'6", scoring guard who can shoot, who can dribble, who can get to the basket, but if you tell him, now I want you to facilitate an offense, I think that's too much for, he's still young, like 22, 21, whatever he is, he's still young, and then he's coming off the ACL, and that's not what he knows. What he knows his whole life is come down the court, pull up, shoot a jumper, come down the court, get to the basket. So I think that, I want to say this, sometimes when you draft your first player and never stand bank on these first draft picks, You tend to just hold on to them a little bit longer, and I wonder if will Stan kind of hold on to him just a little bit longer because that was his guy. Like, that's my pick. Versus it being like, you know, I'm getting rid of him. I'm not saying Steve Blake is garbage and everything like that, but Steve Blake is, like, on the other side of life. He didn't have the year last year either. He's a solid backup point guard who's on his other side of life now. He's on the other side. He's on that 10 to 15 minutes per game other game type, you know, place in life. Because he's not going to defend. He's tough, but he's not going to really stick with a lot of guys right now. And he's sound, but I looked at his numbers, like, it's like his worst shooting is. He was shooting, like, almost worse than KCP. So,
how old is Steve Blake now? Steve Blake's got to be in his 30s now, right? He's 30-something,
yeah,
right?
I mean, he came to league 22, and I looked at him, he came to 2002. So he's been 13 years in the league now.
Yeah, he's up there, man.
Yeah, about 35, 34. So you're not looking at a guy who's going to be every game 20, 25 minutes. You're looking at a guy, like I said, every other game, or if Dinwiddie is struggling or somebody's struggling, to put him in pinch positions. So I don't see him, like, logging heavy minutes. So
right.
I don't know if Spencer Dinwiddie's necessarily out.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, I think that these things are kind of showing him, like, you have to get your game up, because these are the players I'm bringing in to kind of, they're going to push you. I think these are people who are going to be there to push him. And if Spencer Dinwiddie doesn't respond, I think they're going to move him anyway. Because, I mean, our happy would be Reggie Jackson. I know we want to move that shoot guard, but for the sake of this conversation, Reggie Jackson is the first thing. Then we got Dennis, who will get healthy, who can come in and kind of move points, and they can kind of do this rotation, like this three-guard rotation thing. So then you have a guy like Spencer, who could still potentially fit in, because he can also move in a little bit in that two-guard position also, and he's a big guard. So, so with the size of Reggie and with the size of Dennis, a guy like Spencer still has a way to fit in with Billy Meeks and everybody. But it's going to be a tight. I think it's going to be a competition. I think across all my guards, it's going to be competition. I mean, there's only two locking starters. I think that Edwards said it. I think Edwards said it. We only have two locking starters, Reggie and
That's it.
I don't know about this. KCP being a core piece, if he can't be a locked-in starter, but hey,
I think Ilya Sova's a locked-in starter.
Who's that?
Ilya Sova. I think he's a locked-in four. I don't think Marcus Morris is going to play four. I think he's going to be at the three. I think he's going to be competing with Stanley Johnson for that three spot for all those 3 minutes. Him and Stanley, it's good. He's going to put in some work at the power forward as well, but they're not going to start Marcus at the power forward. He's a three. I think Ilya Sova's got that power forward spot locked down. I mean, the minute they traded for him, he was our starting power forward. As long as we didn't sign Monroe, he was our starting power forward.
Yep, you're right. I will tend to agree. I think Ilyasova, SVG was strong on him. He was strong on Ilyasova. When he met Trey, you could tell by his comments. He was strong on him. He knew what he was doing. He was big on him. He's going to start. He's going to get significant minutes. And I told a lot of people that, you know, in my other group that I was in, like, he's going to start. He's the starting power forward. And he made that move to put him there. There's still no doubt about that. But I wanted to say a little bit something about, about Spencer. And the thing about Spencer is, like, I always like big guards. I don't like small guards. I hate small points. I hate them. I hate small guards. I just do. I don't like it. I don't like small guards. It's just some pet peeve for me. But Spencer is, when you look at Spencer.
Does John Lucas piss you off?
No, I hate John Lucas. I do. I hate him. He's talented and everything. I'm like, oh, God, he can't go on. No one can go on. I'm like, oh, God. Spencer, man, he's like, he's a big guy. You can tell that he has a little talent. Because when I watched him in Sunday League, he cannot really blow past anybody. And I'm like, he can't just pass anybody off the dribble. So it was kind of frustrating me. And I just think, like you said, he's a two guy. He's a two guy, and I in the wall, man. They brought in Blake just to put pressure on him. Like, dude, like you said, dude, you better step your game up. And we are in Lindau mode. That move for Blake pretty much was like, yep, we're in Lindau mode. We're shooting for the playoffs. We're not developing players. You're right, Elder. You're right, brother. I have to give it to you. You're right. Especially today's move solidifies that. They're trying to win. They're trying to get to the playoffs. And that's what we're doing.
And I'm excited about it. Like, even with Stanley Johnson, I guess it starts the conversation really with Stanley Johnson. I said it on our last conference call. I said I'm expecting Stanley Johnson to really come in summer league. If you guys remember, I said I really expect him to come in summer league and dominate. And he dominated every game, except for the last game. And I hated the last game. I hate summer league. The last game, the championship games are so stupid. Because they hold it in the morning. It is the most oddest time Like, these players, their whole career, they've been, like, for the last couple of years in college and everything, other than AAU maybe, they've been playing, like, evening games and all this type of stuff, late night games, and you'll come back and put them, like, at 9 a.m. in the morning. That's so stupid to me, but let me get up there. He dominated, like, the first four games across the board, like, and he did it, like, he took his game to a place that even had Stan Van Gundy, like, wow, I didn't know he had that in, like, He held out. Like, he was holding out. Like, I'm going to show them just a little bit something. You have your coach come out. Have your coach, the guy who drafted you, be like, yeah, that's the problem. His ball handling and his dribbling and his passes and his ability to do this and that. It surprised me. And he just looked like, I had this big thing about Summer League. And I really know Summer League. Summer League will be forgotten about. You know, by the time the regular season, nobody's going to be like, oh, they dominated Summer League or they sucked at Summer League. Right. But there are some indications in Summer League about a guy's capabilities. There are certain things that just translate to the next level. Shooting translates in the NBA. I don't care if it's Summer League, college, shooting translates. Ability to get your own shot off translates. I remember the game in the season, we had Solomon Hill. Solomon Hill is a 78-game starter for the Indiana Pacers. And that's who they put on Stanley Johnson. And that's who Stanley Johnson had to defend. He is a third-year player. And Stanley Johnson locked him down, and he could not defend Stanley Johnson. That translates. I was more, like I said, those first four games, I was more than and just, like, I was, like, blown away. Like, the hustle. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, I was blown away. Like, his ball handling and his passing skills? Oh, my. Dude, I never seen that in Arizona. I felt like I watched college basketball. I didn't see them. We were talking about Decker. But you have the system that you play in college definitely defines how you play. And you have to play in college. It's a discipline thing. And you need that because that helps you grow in your game. And you do need that discipline. So that's what you go to college for, to get that discipline, to get the training, to make you a better pro. So I understand that. But the system does hold back to offense. I tell people for years, Tom Izzo in that three-man lead, that holds back player, I hate that. Oh, my God. And people talk about Izzo, oh, Izzo's a decent coach. Don't get me wrong. That's what they're talking about for me. But, you know, like, that three-man lead system, and college systems can help hurt and hinder the development of players. I mean, and it does.
You do.
So, and I just think that you're seeing Stanley develop into, you're seeing it right before your eyes. Like, he's way more than what he was prospected to be. Like, it's more. It's more to that guy. He has the dog in him. I love his attitude. He has the dog in him, man. He wants to be a star. He wants to be a star. He doesn't want to be a regular player in the NBA getting checks. He wants to be a star.
Do any of you like have any like track record of like summer league rookies in the 18-19 year old age range that were standouts in the summer league and where they're at now? Because I want to know the percentage of those kind of players and how they translated into the NBA. Because in my opinion, an 18, 19-year-old that can stand out against, like, a second to third-year player is pretty impressive to me, especially when he's not really had a whole lot of NBA game time action, even though it's not really NBA level. But these are guys that have seen NBA court time. Guys that still are in the summer league might have came off the bench like Elda alluded to that Solomon Hill has had plenty of game time experience in the NBA, and you know, Stanley Johnson went to work on him. So my thing is like, I'm wondering like if there's like a correlation between 18, 19 year old rookies that translated into NBA that were standouts in summer league play. I'm trying to look that up right now. I can't really find anything.
I was trying to look that. I looked, I was looking some stuff up. The only thing I tried to look it up earlier, I think it's crazy with the Summer League, only because Orlando Summer League is so different than Vegas as far as the court and the way they play. everything they do, like, I feel like, I'm not gonna, I don't know which one is easier, harder for players. I want to believe that Nintendo might be a little bit more challenging, only because it just seems like it's a little bit more closed in, like guys can grind a little bit more. It just seems a little more like gym, like real, like gym, like really grinding it out, kind of. And it doesn't seem as much spacing, like the spacing doesn't look as great. So it's like you got to work a little bit harder for your shot versus Vegas. It's like an open floor. But I looked at some of the people. I think it's kind of hard to catch it. It's like odd people who are kind of took off in summer league. Not really a lot of 18, 19-year-olds. It's like, other than Anthony Davis, he had a good summer league. I can't remember Drummond's summer league, but I think they had a list of it. If you look up summer league MVPs, you can kind of get like a feel for it. But I was like, only name that really stood out, Damian Lillard. It was like Damian Lillard, but he's not 18, 19. Damian Lillard came in the league at like 21. And then it was like, I know it was Anthony Davis in the last couple of years. So, and then it's like those odd guys who was like kind of like second and third year type players who was like MVPs. But it's kind of really hard to find like a list of like that 18 to 19-year-old. But I will say this about summer league. And once again, I'm not overhyping it, but summer league has three components going on that a lot of people don't really grab onto. One, guys already know that they're coming to summer league. So they're already practicing, preparing for summer league. The guys who get drafted, they're coming off the draft, and then like a week later, they're going into summer league. So right. That's why they do those two-a-day practices, just to kind of get them up to speed on the game plays and the playbook and everything they're going to run. But there are guys like from a team who would come like a Spencer Dinwiddie, I'm just using for example. That's why I said I'm a little bit harder on him. You knew you were going to be in summer league. You knew for like ever since the season ended, you knew you were going to be in summer league. So right. This was your big thing. So it's not so much all Spencer Dinwiddie, he struggled for four games or five games or he. No, it's the whole fact that you had since, what, March? To kind of prepare yourself to dominate these four games, and you look horrible. Like, you look literally horrible. You look like you didn't understand. And people say things like, oh, he had a new teammate. What they got to do with knocking down a jumper? What they got to do with defending your man? Like, these guys, who's that guy? Athlete, that's your boy.
Go green. But he was killing them. Oh my God, he was.
I'm like, foul him, clip him up or something, because he made him look so bad. Like, first shot blowing by him. So I said, oh, maybe this Adlin dude is like that. Then I watch the next game, and Adlin is struggling to get past the guy. I'm like, so either Spencer don't, but you know, when they first started, I remember they said Spencer defense was his big question mark. Can he defend NBA point guard? And I'm not saying Adlin's an NBA point guard, but that's what his struggle is. He had that one little great moment, well, he had two, against John Wall and against Derrick Rose. Yeah. So then it makes me wonder, is he a game-time performer?
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that Chicago game. Yeah, he had an outstanding game against Chicago. I forgot about that Chicago game.
Yeah, I mean, that's when Derrick Rose was like, he had his legs back. And he was doing a good job. So I wonder if he's like when the adrenaline's pumping, he's like moving. And then he in this atmosphere is kind of really laid back. Like, if he was in Vegas, I wonder how he would have performed, like, with the crowd and...
The crowd around, yeah.
Yeah, but that's not good if, you know, Stan looks at him and says, you know, Spencer, I need you to defend. You go out there and you're not into it. That's showing that maybe you just don't have that quality. Because then you look at a guy like, once again, you look at Cowboy, SJ3, and he get out there, and he's diving on the ball. He's up in his chest. He's blocking shots. You know, he's getting steals. Every other play, it seems like. You know, he's getting to the free throw line. He's doing rebounding. He's doing everything. So I don't just credit somebody. Like, if somebody ran, like, for – it'd be great if it ran, like, for, like, 2 weeks and they play, like, 10 games. I think that would be really good. You kind of really get a feel for a guy and consistency. But I'm concerned about Spencer. But I'm excited about because I don't see the box on that team. I mean, Adonis Thomas, he had a good summer league, but I don't think he makes the roster, even with the cut.
Right.
Just has
no.
Like, I don't think no player on that team is going to make the – I mean, other than, you know, Hillard. I thought Hillard was kind of up and down, but he showed good intensity on defense.
Mm-hmm.
He had dribbles. His dribbling skills – I mean, I looked at his highlight, so I wasn't, like, totally, like, surprised. Like, because he did show a lot of – in his highlight, bro. He showed a lot of being able to dribble and get to the basket. He had a nice little crossover. So he did the same thing in the highlights he did in summer league. But I think these are guys who are going to kind of – there's only a few guys on that summer league who's really going to make – who's going to make it to training camp. And then from training camp, we're going to see what happens. Like, would he got to be sent to D-League or be cut or waived or whatever. So, but I was more than impressed with Johnson. I was more than impressed.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even just scoring, because I know he could score.
Right.
It was just that ball – it was a time when – I don't know if you guys watched it in the highlights. It's like they trapped him at half court. He split the double team, crossed over with another guy, and then went to the lane and laid up. It's like he could get to the lane like anytime he wanted to. And it was just like, I was just impressed. They was double teaming him. Like, by the time the second game, teams were literally double teaming him. They was like, we want the ball out of his hand. Like, they was did their game plan to double team him. And, I mean, that's impressive to me, man. That's impressive.
And the thing is, what else was impressive about him was he never seemed like he was forcing the shot. Like, it never seemed like he forced the shot. He played whatever the defense gave to him. I love that about him. Like you said, when they double teamed, he made the proper pass. And when he had the shot, he took the shot. The only thing we know he got to improve on is that free throw, because he got to shoot better free throws.
Dennis got to come on that the whole time. Like, he shoots a flat shot.
Flat shot. He kept saying
it. And Dennis kept saying it. Like, every time, that was his like, baby, he shoots a flat shot. I like to see him get that ball up here above his nose.
Get up there, young fella. He kept saying that.
Out of all the players that we could have drafted, we got another guy that can't shoot free throws. I mean... Figures, right?
Yeah. I think he'd be fine, though. I think he'll be fine.
Yeah, he'll be fine. I think that's something you can work on and get better at. You know, you can work on that. You put time in practice and, you know, extra time shooting free throws. You know, he'll be a better free throw shooter because he wants it. He wants it. I am not concerned about Stanley Johnson, and I have no concerns about that guy. That guy is a baller. He's a gamer.
I read something about Stanley Johnson. They said it. It's two things I read. I read one, you know, in college. You know, someone posted it. I'm not sure if it was Mike Campbell or someone posted that his high school career, and he talked about like his development. Like he went from just an energy guy, like a power forward energy guy, and then he went from a power forward who could score, and then by the time it's like his last year in college, they put him as like almost like a point forward. Because he just got better and better every year. And then in high school, he shot like under 30% for three. So going into college, it was like his jump shot, you know, he's not going to be a jump shooter. He's going to be a slasher. He's going to be a rebounder. He's going to be this. So then he comes to college and he jumps to shoot 37% for three.
37%, right.
So it's just showing you, like, every time they say something he can't do, he goes and, like, he's driven to prove that he can. And then I was reading that, like, they said that, you know, his jump shot is compact. So it's like a compact jump shot, so it's not a lot of motion in it. But they said that's good, because that means that you have higher repetition. And like, I hope they don't change it too much. I just hope they don't change it too much and, you know, mess them up. You know what I mean? I don't want to change his mechanics too much.
Yeah, because he's confident in it. Like he said, when you say he's late asking about it, he specifically says, I'm confident about my jump shot. And when he shoots it confidently. There's no hesitation or nothing.
Nope. And I like that about him.
And he lets it fly, man. His athleticism's out the roof, man. That block that I put up earlier today, man. I mean, he went up there with no effort whatsoever. He just went up there and got it out of his hands, man.
And if you trace back that play, he drives down the floor. He's fouled.
Yep.
He's fouled.
Yep.
And I think he looks at the ref for like a minute. He just looks at the ref, and then they stop and play. And he literally chases that play down. He literally chases that play down. Because I was like, yo, I was like, he came out of nowhere.
Yep. Hello.
These are athletes. Whether they're in the end of the draft, they're really questioning his athleticism. Like, that was like all the time to be a question. You remember that, Elvis?
Yeah, that's because they kept on saying, you know, he said it too. You know, I go back and I listen to these interviews. He said that people question his athleticism because how he finished in the paint. Like, his percentage was really like low. It's like 55. And what? Other guys, like, you know, Decker was like 70, Winslow's like 66. So they were like, you know, so they're saying these guys are more athletic. And I'm not going to say that Decker, because I really do believe Decker's really a really good athlete. But I just think that him showing me, what he showed me today, maybe showed me that it was a product of more of a system that maybe caused some of those things versus him. Like, when you put the ball in a guy's hand and then you say, go get me a bucket, like, he's a guy who we can say, we down 3 points, or we down two. I need you to get me a bucket. We haven't had a guy like that in like forever. So you just put the ball in your hand and say, "Get me a bucket."
Yep. Forever. Like, even like we and so long. It's been like almost 15 some years. Like, it's been a long time, man.
Yeah, it's been a long time. I mean, Chauncey could score. Like, Chauncey was cut. Like, Chauncey would pull up. Chauncey had a little hesitation. And Chauncey had all, and he had that, you know, and I'm not knocking Chauncey, but if you go look at some of Chauncey's stats, Chauncey was shooting between like 42%, 43%.
Right.
He had 1 year. So even though he was clutching, he did all the things, and I'm all hell to Chauncey. I'm not going to come at my boy, but he wasn't like necessarily like, he did it out of just that competitive nature in him. I need to score, but not the physical tools, like, I'm going to get this bucket and like, I know that they're going to have to trap me. They're going to have to double-team me. We have a guy that teams are going to have to double-team. Like, they're going to have to double-team.
There you go. Elder. Yep. We haven't had a guy that we had that team had to double-team in a long time. Like, we haven't had it. There you go.
Not off the perimeter, anyway. We haven't had a guy like that. I mean, we have Rasheed a little bit. Like, when Rasheed got real, real good in the post, teams were like, play with him. But, you know, Rasheed didn't really want to be. I'm gonna get off topic, but I love Rasheed and everything he did. But Rasheed made me mad, man. He never wanted to be a go-to player, and I think that hindered us to even push to those championships. Like, if he says only time he wanted to be the go-to player was when he made those guarantees, and he was like, "All right, now I said it. Now I'm getting the ball." But day in, day out type stuff, it'd be too late. But now we have a guy who I feel like he wants to. Now, I believe Reggie Jackson does too, and I believe Drummond does too. But it's good that we have a good three players who we can look at and say these guys could potentially be like all-star quality players. And Stanley Johnson and Drummond, they have like that superstar type personality, like fun-loving, you know, lovable, kind of like say the right thing. But we have three guys who I feel like for the first time we have like really three guys who can really move into that all-star level. And that's comforting. And it's comforting. It really is. It really is comforting.
What I love about Stanley Johnson as well is that how many off-the-ball plays did he have where he was making plays? You know, he didn't need to be ball dominant whatsoever. You know what I mean?
Right.
So it's like, I feel like Reggie can still do his damn thing. You know what I mean? He could still be the ball dominant guard that he is, but on top of that, I feel like Stanley Johnson's IQ is like so much through the roof that he makes just plays with the ball not in his hands, in his hands. It just doesn't matter. He's going to be effective either way, and I really, really like that about him, and I think it really might mesh well with Reggie as well. I really think so.
You know, what I really like about this team is that I believe now, and it's not a knock on Drummond or anything, but if we go West Coast, and we go to the West Coast, and we had to play small, to keep up with, like I say, a Golden State. I'm not saying we would just win them or run them out the building, but we have the ability to match with any kind of team right now. Like,
yes, we do.
If we want to, if we play, like, I think Stan said, we play like a Memphis or we play Chicago and they want to go big, we can go big too. If we go out west and they want to go small ball, we can run small ball too. And I also believe, and I also said this, like, if Drummond, like, and I always believe, like, good bigs will always beat small ball. So, if, like I said, if Drummond gets gets that jump hook shot up to about 50% to 55%,
mm-hmm.
and the team says, we're going to play small ball, Drummond is athletic enough to run and get back on defense. And I'm not saying you can't stretch the floor, and you know we don't want him to be out there defending, what's his name, Draymond Green. But Draymond Green would beat him off the dribble. But to bring him back down the other side with offensive rebounding and being able to post up, people punish small ball. I believe we just have a lot of versatility, and it's...
Yo.
You know, we had to play Drummond. It was no versatility. Now yep. we have interchangeable pieces. Like, and we don't even talk about Tulliver no more. We got Tulliver. You know, we got Mark Morrison. You know, we got Stanley Johnson. We could put it out. If we really wanted to, we could bring Marcus Morris, Stanley Johnson.
Yes,
we could play KCP at small forward. We could play Meeks at shooting guard and Reggie. Or we can always want Jennings come back. We go Jennings at point guard, Reggie Jackson at shooting guard. We could go, what his name is? We could go Stanley still at small forward because he's still switching defense. We go Marcus Morris at power forward. We'll go Ilya Sova at center.
Yeah, I was going to say Ilya Sova
with this lineup. We can do anything with this lineup, and I think that's the thing we're kind of building. It's a versatile lineup with interchangeable pieces built around your superstars, though.
And maybe if, like I said, I haven't seen a whole lot of game film on him. Actually, Elda, you're like the expert on the guy, but like, if not Ilya Sova at center, if we're going small or trying to run fast pace, maybe Aaron Baines comes in, man, and fills in at the center position nicely.
I think he would be there. I'm sorry, go ahead, Edwin.
No, Adam, he asked you, so go ahead, man. Yep.
No, I'm going with your thoughts, man.
I was just going to say, I disagree with you saying. Like, I like him as way more versatile now. Like, we can go big. Like, we can go drumming and bass together. Like, we want to go, you want to go big. So I was thinking, like, I agree with totally what you said, man. We got so many versatile pieces now. It's a whole better, more balanced lineup than we had. And then what I was going to say is, there's three components, I think, to where you have a really good team. I think you must have in your starting lineup. You got to have a good point guard. You got to have a good small forward. And you got to have a good big. You can interchange a shooting guard. You can interchange a power forward. That's just what I think. But you got to have a good point guard, a good small forward, and a really good center. And if you have those components in your starting lineup, you might can make some noise.
Yeah, and I believe that. I mean, I don't know how soon. And I'm going to answer the Baines question. But I don't know how soon. Like I said, I don't know how soon Stanley Johnson is going to be starting. I would love for him to start from day one. Not because of the whole rookie and I want to be rookie of the year stuff. But I believe I want him to actually win the position. I want him to win the position. And maybe by the time Christmas, even if it's about Christmas, I would love to see him as, like, the start. And if he has the ability, I don't want no giveaway. I'm in win mode. So if Marcus Morris is going to help us produce more wins right now than Stanley Johnson, I can wait on Stanley Johnson. Because, I believe in him. And I'm all about winning. I'm sorry. I'm not just player development mode. I've been in player development mode for, like, the last 10 years with the Pistons.
10 years?
But Baines, when I was reading about him, he's really, I think somebody said it today. They said on maybe with SportsCenter, or maybe I listened to him. Maybe I was standing there, and he was talking about it on the video where he was introducing Baines. He said a lot of people only know him from what he did with the Spurs. He said, but we went back further, like, to what he did overseas. And he said he's actually shown, like, anything, like, from the free throw line in. They said, like, he can score from the free throw line in because he has a jump shot. He has, he can kind of take another big off the dribble. He has a spin move. They say he has a jump hook. When you look at his percentages, it reflects what he's saying. It's not like, and if you say these little sample size stuff, but his stuff is not even sample size. Like, he played more games than Seattle Splitter last year, and he played more minutes, and he actually had better numbers. And you look at his starter numbers, he has really strong starter numbers. So I just think that he has a good little mid-range, like that 15 to 16-foot jumper, that's solid. So when we go big, like I said, we can, if Drummond has to come out of the game or Drummond stays in the game, it's not necessarily clogging up the paint because he can shoot the jumper that Greg Monroe wouldn't shoot. And he can hit the jumper that Josh Smith wouldn't make. So, and you're getting a big physical guy. Like, this is like a tough Piston team. Like, we have some, if Drummond comes back nasty, like physically, like, and then we have Baines, we have Marcus Morris, we have Stanley Johnson. I mean, even at point guard, Reggie's defense is a little bit more suspect. It's kind of suspect. But Reggie is a big physical guard. So if he decides to really lock in and be, I mean, he got like a seven-foot wingspan. So he has all the tools to really be a great defender at the point guard. I don't know if he has the awareness. Something is off. But physically, he can dominate point guard on defense. And I just think we have a really good physical team.
All right, so kind of switch gears up here.
Oh, do a little roundup, Mike. The Seahawks, we have some games. The Seahawks on the line.
Yeah, who's all here right now? Who's all here right now?
Hello.
Who's this?
I'm Dickie.
Oh, Dickie. How you doing?
Hi. Groovy, how are you?
I'm doing great. Doing great.
Hi. Just listening and driving.
As per usual, right?
Right. Get out of work, start driving around. That's what you do.
That's what you do, and talk Pistons basketball. I like it. Who else is here?
That's right.
Don.
Johnny?
Don.
Okay, Don who?
God.
John.
God. Oh, it's Merlin. It's still Merlin.
Is it Merlin?
It's Merlin.
Is it Merlin? Because I'm like lost. Oh, he's a God.
It's Merlin. Yes, he's a God. You gotta speak Merlin.
Don.
I'm driving right now, and I got you on my car speaker. It's a new device of mine, so I'm not used to it. So I'm like, I don't know. It kind of feels like I'm saying to the ticket, only better and participating. So, yeah.
Awesome. That's what I like.
Merlin, you know.
Sweet. Okay, who else do we got? We got Dickie, we got God, we got Edwin, Elda. Who else?
That might be it. All right.
That might be it. Okay.
Okay, cool.
Sounds good. So, kind of switch up gears here, man. Everybody's favorite topic as of late. Elda's favorite guy. Mr. Kentavious Tano. Caldwell Pope.
Tannel. I never trust a man named Tannel.
Okay, Elder, clear this up for us, man. What's a core player, man? What is your definition of a core player?
And we will
form our opinion off of your definition.
Okay. When I think core player, I'm thinking a guy who you look at as a long-term solution for that position on your team. This is a person who has shown you that they are your long-term part of your team. And not just like, oh, if they get better, oh, if they do this. They've shown you that they are your long-term solution for the position. Can they be upgraded? Yes. By a better player, teams do it all the time. just this last week, they said, the Milwaukee Bucks, they said, we look at John Henson as our long-term solution, as a core piece of what we're building here. To me, the idea is that because he's a center, he's a big, he's shot blocking, he's rebounding, he can score in the post. They're looking at him like he's our long-term solution. We're not going to go out and try to find another one. We good. I don't believe that the Pistons are saying that same thing about KCP. I don't hear it. I don't hear the vote of confidence from the coaches. I don't hear it from the just to make you feel like he is that. I don't feel that. Now, do I believe that KCP can be better? Yes. Do I recognize that he's only 21, 22 years old? Yes. Do I believe in potential? I do believe in it. But I see 2 years of inconsistency, and I think he gets so kind of like that like, because he's ours, and we look at him like, oh, that chase down block. Remember that chase down block? Remember that time he hit those 5 threes in a row? Yeah.
Right.
I remember him getting right up by Bradley Beal for 40 points or 30 points. I remember him going through a stretch of like 6-7 games where he was like shooting like 20% for threes. And,
yep.
And yes, he hustles. Yes, he hustles. And yes, he's a good energy guy. But are there about 20 other shooting guards that I would take over here right now?
Yes, absolutely.
Are there rookies? And I mean, it was things that was said this week that was like blowing my mind. Someone say KCP is a top 10 shooting guard.
Oh my gosh.
Then they said we could have got a top 10 pick for KCP in this draft. We could have got a top 7. They said top 7. We could have got a top 7. I read that he's better than Dwayne Wade. He's better than Dwayne Wade. So when
maybe maybe Dwayne Wade 2 years from now.
When Dwayne
Not even that.
Better than Dwayne Wade when Dwayne Wade is retired and is laying in bed with Gabrielle Union. He would never be Dwayne Wade.
Absolutely not. No way.
When I hear these things, clearly people don't get this. Now, what I heard was then we hear things like, oh, he's a core player off the bench. He can be a core player in 2-3 years from now. He could be a core player if he ever gets consistent. He could be a core player if he ever learns to dribble. That's not a core player. That's potential. So right now, I'm saying I'm okay with KCP. I really am. I don't think he's the best shooting guard on our roster. I believe Meeks is. I believe Meeks is the better shooting guard on our roster for what we need. I think people, once again, we look at KCP defense, and he is a good defender. He's not an elite defender. He's a good defender. But he doesn't do anything else. He doesn't bring it up to the table. He doesn't score off the dribble. He doesn't rebound at this high percentage. He shoots poorly, and he's inconsistent. Those are concerns.
On top of that.
Okay.
Oh, go ahead.
He's a volume shooter on top of that, too.
And that's the thing. In college, that was my concern about him coming out of college. He was a volume shooter. He shoots the ball like 19, 20 times a game.
Yep.
And he kind of plays that same way now, but it's like, I was like, Stan Van Gundy has given him the green light to be this way, because obviously, or is it because we really don't have any other option? Because you remember Meeks was hurt. Like, we got to realize Meeks was hurt. Most people agree that Meeks was going to be the starting shooting guard. Most people agree.
Yep, absolutely.
Most people agree. And then as soon as Meeks got his legs together, he shot better than Casey.
Yeah.
He was moving without the ball. You've seen his effect. So I just refuse to believe it. I'm sorry. Now, what they do in training, I don't know how much hard work KCP has put in during the summer. I don't know what he's going to come back looking like. I don't know. You know, maybe he's in a group under somebody's alias. When you see me talking about him and he's just going to get motivated by it, and he's going to be star quality player. I don't know, but we can't just keep doing this with ourselves, man. This is how you get trapped with players. Like, you start looking at them and you overvalue a guy, and they're just not that person. They're not who we want them to be. We got to look at who they are. He's a 40% from the field goal. He's a 40% from the field shooter. He's a high-volume shooter who shoots the ball like 13 times a game and averages like 13, 14 points. he's a 34.5 if you want to be technical, percent three-point shooter, but he shoots like 6 threes a game. So
right.
It's like, you hurting us. I mean, if we didn't have Drummond, we would have lost even more games, because Drummond is the one cleaning up all those misses. Like, maybe Drummond need to really bench KCP, because he gives them all those offensive rebounds. Drummond probably knows he's going to miss them, and the anticipation is already there. He's going to miss, and I'm going to get offensive rebounds.
If KCP was on the team, Drummond would only average 7 rebounds a game. That's fact.
He doesn't give you assists. He doesn't give you any assists, and he doesn't give you rebounds. So,
right.
Efficiency as a shooting guard is very, very low. So I just can't, just to say, because he's 21, 22, and is a second year in the league, that he's just going to kaboom in his third. Dickie, I want to be wrong. I want you to be right. I want KCP to have a great year. I'm a Pistons fan. I want KCP to have a great year. It'll be easier. But as a core piece, I consider Drummond a core piece. And I consider Stanley Johnson, based off of where he went in the draft, a core piece in this draft. Remember, KCP came out in a horrible draft. That was a horrible draft KCP came out. Yes, he was a lottery pick in a horrible draft. So, and I value, only because they gave him the contract, I value Reggie Jackson as a core piece. But that's it.
Right.
I don't see KCP as a core piece. He's a player on our roster.
Yeah.
And that's
I want to note a couple of things. First of all, interestingly enough, you basically just described KCP as a taller Ben Gordon. But at least taller Pistons Ben Gordon. But with regards to him being a core piece, there is one thing I do want to know. I think Van Gundy thinks of him as a core piece. But here's the thing. If you look at all the people that Van Gundy came out and said he considers a core piece, last year he included Monroe. This year he talked about Jackson and Drummond. He only says that publicly when it's about players in contract years. If you notice that. Anybody who's up for an extension or they're a free agent, that's who he says it about. Have you noticed that?
I agree.
Oh, repeat it for me, guys. I'm sorry. Right, breaking up. I couldn't hear very well. I'm sorry.
You're kind of breaking out a little bit. You're kind of like in the distance a little bit. Can you, any way you can turn yourself up?
Are you there?
Yeah, we're here. We can barely hear you, man.
Hang on. Are you
there? Yeah, we're here.
Okay.
There we go.
No, what I'm saying was, if you pay attention, if you look at it, when he came out, a couple of things. One, you basically described KCP as the taller Ben Gordon, and except without the lights out shooting years in Chicago. If you look at KCP though, like when Van Gundy comes out and says that a certain player is a core piece. The only times he mentions core pieces are always players that are in contract years. You know, he talked about Drummond. He talked about Monroe last year. He talked about, watch, next year he will publicly be like, KCP is a core piece. And if you think about it, Drummond, Jackson, and KCP are spending a shit ton of time together, which means that they consider each other core pieces, which is going to play into Van Gundy. Now, I absolutely love the way Stanley Johnson played in Summer League. I think he's going to be fantastic for our team. But there is one thing that I do have to know, just so I don't get too hyped up myself, and I think others should at least take this into account. Who was the MVP of the Summer League 3 years ago, and he did it twice in a row? Austin Day.
Yeah, Austin Day.
Austin Day was the best player in Summer League 2 years in a row. He was unstoppable.
But did Austin Day do this in his rookie year? That's what I want to know.
Huh?
Did Austin Day do this in his rookie year?
Year, though.
he was good his rookie year. He was one of the best, but he wasn't number one. His second and third year, he was, like, dominant. Like,
right. Right. I remember Austin Day in his second and third year. I mean, he was lighting it up from everywhere. He was because he was a hard matchup, because I think they were playing him at power forward, weren't they, at the time? In the summer league,
he was like that. Yeah.
He was a very hard matchup. But my thing is, like, I'm not making excuses for Austin Day, but the thing that impresses me about Stanley Johnson is he's doing this as a rookie at 19 years old. That's what impresses me.
I'm not saying I'm not impressed. I'm definitely impressed. I'm not pessimistic. I really do think he's going to be lightning in a bottle. The reason why I'm being cautious, you know, I'm not letting myself get too excited, is because, and not to sound like too disturbing here, but I swear to God, Pistons fans, when Austin Day was going off at the summer league, I swear to God, Pistons fans were like dudes watching girl-on-girl porn.
That is true.
I'm just saying. So I'm not comparing watching Johnson to watching girl-on-girl porn, because the fact of the matter is, with the Austin Day situation, when the dudes met those girls, it turned out they were both really, really attractive dudes. You know what I mean? Like, they just couldn't do it in the real world. They couldn't. That's how often
they. How attractive?
Look at Austin Day summer league as a rookie. But I do know he did his second and third year, because they kept on sending him back there, and he did do well in his second and third year. But that's what I'm saying, the second and third year players do it. And Austin Day was also, what, he had 2 years in college, or three years in college?
Well, he also had like a 7 foot billion wingspan.
Right.
I think it was too, but I'm just saying, people got all excited and hyped about him. But honestly, like, I think when Austin Day played in summer league, the kind of advantage he had over the summer league players was the same advantage Michael Jordan had in the final second of the game against the Monstars in Space Jam. Long reach. You know what I'm talking about? He had that super long reach and nobody could stop
right.
him.
Right.
That's the same thing. But everybody was still hyping him, like, oh my God, Austin Day is going to light it up, you know? So because of that, I don't want to get too excited about Johnson, but sadly, I kind of am, though. He's pretty awesome. But the thing is, like, too, you got to realize, I think KCP's still going to stay in the starting lineup simply because that gives us the kind of of bench firepower no team can contend with. Unless, now here's the thing though. If Jennings comes off the bench and starts playing like lightning, I anticipate Meek starting and Jennings going to the bench. KCP going to the bench, unless he takes another step. But until Jennings really has his quickness, they're going to want somebody who can handle the ball and shoot like out. They're going to want Meek on the second unit.
I think I look at it this way. My thing, like I said, for KCP is about consistency. And I've always said this. The big thing is consistency. We talked about him being great at home and horrible on the road and everything right. like that. But some of his stuff is just like, it's just consistency. And I'm a big person about when it matters.
Maybe he's going to take his teddy bear on the road
with him. Yeah, it's a lot of factors with him. That I just think that this needs to be really considered about KCP. And I don't think we as Pistons fans should just be so naive and just be like, oh, he's untouchable. No, he's gold. He's not gold. He's not gold until he proves himself, and he has to prove it through consistency. Name a team that's really competitive, like for playoffs, in and out, and has a shooting guard that's like inconsistent. Like they don't know what they're going to get from their shooting guard on any given night, you know?
Yep.
It just doesn't work that way, especially when you have other, unless you just have a dominant team, unless you make your shooting guard like a Bruce Bowen, like, you know, that type of guy who's just, you know, is going to be a lockdown defender, who's going to be all NBA defensive, second, third team,
type of guy who's going to knock down that corner three. Unless you got that type of guy, you know, you just don't have these just random shooting guards because he becomes so replaceable. And I just feel like if he comes back this third year, and I hate keep saying it, if he comes back this third year and it looks like his second year, Sam ain't gonna, he's not going for that, man. He's not going to be like, okay, he's only 23, we still have more time. Like, he's not even 24. No, he's going to be like, all right, let's make the move. Let's make the switch. You know, Meek come in. And so, Meek, I said this last time, Meek in the last 30 games, he outshot KCP across the board. And he just outperformed him. And KCP may have stayed in, you know, just due to the fact of the rotation and what we had going on and a lack of quickness or whatever we had happening. But it doesn't make sense to keep him if he starts these first 20 games off in the same thing, like shooting both.
Especially after, here's my thing. I want to see what he does after an entire off season of working with a specialized shooting coach. If he can't pull it together, no, I got you on that. If he can't pull it together, because I really do think the team looks at KCP as a core piece, but if he can't pull it together after an off season with the shooting coach, especially if everybody else improves. I mean, if Drummond can learn how to fucking shoot and KCP is gone. That's just a fact. Like, if Drummond starts putting in more free throws than KCP or even float, I think Van Gundy's going to be like, listen, you're not untouchable anymore. I mean, you can touch yourself, but you're not untouchable on my roster.
Wow.
I think I agree with everything you guys say about KCP. I think the biggest thing about me, the biggest thing for me is that in order for the Pistons to have a really successful season this year, one of these guys that we keep on saying, just wait another year. One of these guys that we keep saying that about, Drummond, KCP, I can't think of anybody else offhand, but those are the two main ones. One of them have to really have a breakout year this year. If not both, but one of them at least have to have a really good breakout year this year. And I got a feeling it's going to be probably our big man at the center, not our two-guard that's inconsistent all the time. That's just my personal feeling. But with that being said, KCP really needs to have this breakout year that everybody's been alluding to. But on top of that, if he's showing marginal improvements year after year, it's just no time for that at that particular position. We need a guy that can shoot. We need a guy that can score. I don't know any other team that waits for a shooting guard to start putting up high numbers in their fifth year. You know what I mean? You're either a shooting guard that can score or you're not a shooting guard that can score. You know what I mean? It's black or white. You know what I mean? So it's like...
Yeah.
With that being said, we do need a shooting guard that can put up high numbers, that can put the ball in the basket. I mean, that's literally all KCP has to worry about on the offensive end. He doesn't have to worry about setting up the offense. He doesn't have to worry about bringing the ball up the court. He just has to worry about putting the ball in the basket and do it consistently and do it at a high number. And
let me say this. If we had an average, like KCP, I believe KCP is an above average defender. I believe he's a good defender. But even if we had an average defender who could shoot, that makes our team better than a person who can defend but can't shoot. Teams are just going to start to not respect them. They don't look at him as streaks, and they're not going to respect him because he only has one trick, that's shooting. He may come back this year. Once again, we're going by what we know. He can't really put the ball on the floor. He's great in open floors, like transition. He's quick in transition. He runs the floor well in transition. But once the half-court set comes down, all he had is that one pump fake. And once if a person goes for the pump fake, he got two moves. He got one where he dribbles a little bit, and he turns the 24-footer into the 17-foot pull-up jumper. He has that move. And then he also has the other move, where if it's in trench, and if the person really bites in the lane open, he can go in for the layup or a dunk or something like that. He has that. But he doesn't have, I'm going to break this guy down, kick him off the dribble. He doesn't have that. So, as a Jody Meeks had that. Jody Meeks kicks guys off the dribble, and he has that little spin move, hook shot, floater thing he has in the lane. He has an offensive arsenal. So, I feel more comfortable putting the ball to Jody Meeks and needing a bucket than I would in KCP. And I know KCP going to pull up for that three, but I don't think he can get to the lane and be this man. Once again, we don't know what's going to happen between what he's been working on, but he never had it. He's never had that natural dribbling break down his man ability. Jody Meeks has developed it over time. So do we wait for KCP to just get that or not? So my thing is I'd rather have the solid defender who can shoot rather than the really good defender who can't shoot. And right now, KCP is a really good defender. He's not shooting well.
I don't even think he's that great a defender. I think he's a little bit above average defender, in my opinion. Just my opinion. But yeah, what were you going to say, Merlin? Yeah, no. KCP, I think he brings a lot of energy on the defensive end, but I don't think he's a lockdown defender whatsoever. I think he's a very good defensive guy. I just don't think I don't think what he brings on the defensive end warrants him to be on the court at all times, in my opinion. That's just me. He's a big body. I think that's the biggest upside about him,
He's got great measurables.
Yeah, he's got great measurables, but I don't know, man. He should be a bench player, in my opinion. He really should be a bench player. But go ahead, Merlin.
No, I'm just saying, I miss having somebody like Lindsey Hunter, who could just come off the bench and all of a sudden it didn't matter if he scored or not. You knew whoever their guy was not scoring. It didn't matter. They're scoring too much. Fuck it. Bring Lindsey in. I don't care who we got to sacrifice. They ain't scoring. Dwayne Wade, I don't care. He's on fire, no big deal. Kobe Bryant, bring him in. Don't give a damn. We're shutting the dude down. You know what would be really funny? And I don't know if anybody else would get this, but, these phone calls, I think one of these, just one, I can only handle one of these phone calls, but I think this phone, like, one phone call with Jay Breeze Carter on the line would be, insane. Just because, everybody you talk about, he'd be like, dude, that motherfucker is the truth right there, and if you don't believe it, you ain't a real Pistons fan. KCP is the next Ray Allen, and if you don't believe it, you're not a real Pistons fan. I don't know why.
I love Jay Breeze Carter.
Really?
I love him.
He would be hilarious on the line, though. One time. I can deal with it one time. Just because he would it doesn't matter who it is, he worships them.
That's why I love him.
You love the extreme, unnecessary optimism. Okay.
I love it. I'm like, there's no way we're winning. He's like, yes, we're winning. I'm like, I don't know how you're going to say that, but... And sometimes he was right, but,
Here's what drove me nuts about him is that when he flat out would say that if you don't believe something that was 100% obviously not real, then you weren't a real Pistons fan. Come on, you don't have to say that about everything. Tolliver is going to be the greatest power forward in the league. You just watch. If you don't believe it, you ain't a real Pistons fan. What?
Wait, you don't think Tolliver is going to be the greatest power forward to ever exist on the face of the planet?
No, and I guess I'm not real. I don't know why I just started thinking about him. I just did because I'm like, wow, I just realized there's been no blatant optimism on this line. And then I'm like, oh, wait, that's because there's been no J. I'm excited, and I am excited for this coming year. You have no idea. My girl is seriously I guarantee you. She says she's cool with it. I know in her mind she's terrified for the start of Pistons season. All of a sudden, like, all she's going to do is, like, see me go from button-downs and slacks and looking all professional to fucking blue and red and everyone shut the fuck up.
My girl just came up here and was like, are you off the phone yet? Are you off the phone? I'm like, nope, not yet.
My last conference call, I made my girl wait an hour because I got sucked into the call with you guys. I feel really bad, too. I felt really bad. I felt really bad.
I'm glad y'all relationship issues on me and Mike either.
Oh, no, there were no relationship issues. Let's just say I had to put an extra couple of 10 or 20 horsepower
There should be a disclaimer right before we enter the phone conference, like this will do not blame or no lawsuits or something like that can be put on Elda or Mike for your ruined right. relationship. Or the, yeah.
just blame Merlin.
What is
blame God?
I was about to say it, Nikki. I was about to be like, yeah, I guess you can just blame God. It's God's will, also known as Merlin.
Is Evan still on the line? Yeah, I want to hear your thoughts, son, because I knew you was like a, I want to say you were a strong KCT, but you did.
Hey,
he was a strong team.
Hey,
what's up?
My thing about KCT was.
Hey, real quick, I'm throwing you guys on mute, but I'm not leaving, so I got to order some food. So you're not going to hear me, but I'm still here, all right?
All right, we got
it. Good deal. My thing was, I still don't see, like, any long-term options that we have to do. My thing was, I think they're going to give him a chance. That's all I was pretty much saying. Like, I was just big on, like, where are my other options? Like, you know, and I hear what you're saying that Meek is a scorer. Like, that's the one thing. Meek has always been a scorer. He's been a tough out since college. He's a scorer. It's proven. Like, I think he's just funky. Like, he's a scorer. Like, the guy's a scorer. So I understand where you're coming with Meek. I just don't know if he's. I'm always long term, man. I just think Jordan Meek, I think he's his role is better if he just comes off the bench as a six. I think he'll be a perfect six man. I think he'd be an awesome six just to come in and score like he was. I think that's his role. I think that's his best role. I don't know if that's right. Like, him being a long-term starter is our answer there. And maybe he is better than KDP. My thing was, they're going to give him a shot. His contract's perfect. They're going to give him a shot to see if he can do it. And I always said this year was going to be his make or break year. If he doesn't do it this year, he's out of here. And I still hold that true. But I think they're going to give him a shot, man. I think they're going to give him a shot. But I think this is his last shot. The line's going to roll. It's definitely on the wall. But Hill and Dinwiddie. If you don't bring in another playing guy unless you're pushing somebody. So the writing's on the wall for both of those guys. I really believe that.
And I think that's my thing. I just feel like this. Like, I mean, if we really believed in, and I'm going to say Stan Van Gundy, if he really believed in KCP, I don't think he would have went for Danny Green. You don't offer a max guy. Danny Green, was, if we got Danny Green, he was starting a shooting guard. Let's believe it.
He was going to start a shooting guard.
So if we really saw him as a core piece, we wouldn't go for Danny Green. You know, we would have did it. I just don't think you do those things and you have a core person because you would be like, we have our Danny Green. I think Danny Green is a good player. I don't consider him a core piece. I think he's good for what the Spurs is, and he's a specialty player. Right. He defends well, and he can shoot well in that system. But I don't see Danny Green. So, but if we had got him, KCP goes to the bench. Or they would find some weird way of putting Danny Green a small forward something like that. But then it makes you wonder about other things, like what would happen with the theory of this team. I don't think Danny Green comes to the Pistons at $11, $12 million to sit on the bench. You know, I just don't see
If they got Danny Green, he was starting. No doubt about that, because he's a two. So he was going to start at two. I'm totally with you on that.
So I think that's my only thing. And I just think, and once again, I'm not saying what KCP cannot become. I don't know. Like, a lot of guys, they do blossom. It takes them a while to get it. Maybe this will be here to get it. But if he doesn't get it this year, I just don't see the patience. I think we're in win now. I mean, I'm happy about it. I'd rather be in win now mode than be like the 76ers and just be like, well, we'll get another draft pick. Well, next year we're going to try to get Ben Simmons. Or, you know, next year we're going to try to get this top number one rookie. I mean, it's great when at the end of the year, your team may make it. I'm the number one person yelling, let's tank. I'm always like that. I'm always going to be that way. And we are 15 games out, and we got like 20 games left. I don't want us to win out another game. I want to lose every game to get to the lowest thing because we're not going to make the playoffs. And there's no reason to have this big old more victory winning the last 5 games in a row, and we go from a 5th pick to an 8th pick. I hate it.
Right.
I hate it. I hate it. But
I hate it.
At the very beginning of the season, all I'm thinking is playoffs. I'm thinking we're playoffs. We're 10 games out of the playoff spot, playoffs. We're 15 games out of the playoff spot, playoffs. But when you get down to that last 15, 20 games, and we're 15, 20 games out, I'm like, tank. Because it's stupid to pick the playoffs. So I think that for KCP, I just believe that this has to be his year. Me and Mike keep saying it, everybody keeps saying it, this has to be his year. And I'm not even saying he has to come out and average like 20 points a game and all this. Like, I'm talking about shooting 44% from the field and at least 37% for threes. Can I get that?
Yep.
44%. Yep. Let me show you the difference between 44% and 40%. People say there's no difference. It is. That means you shot more games over 45%. And you shot under 40%. That means KCP has more games where he shot under 40% than he did over 45%. That means he has less games where he wasn't even close to being close to 50% shooting. That shows nothing but inconsistency. And even on the road, he shoots 44%. I mean, at home, he shoots 44%. That's a level of inconsistency. So when people say there's no difference between 40% and 44%, there is a difference. That means he shot more games when he was 4 for 10 from the field than he did when he was actually like 5 for 50 or something like that, 15 or something. He's just inconsistent. That scares me. It scares me. And I'm looking for consistency in KCP. I want him to get to the basket. I want him to score. I want him to be around. If he shoots 44% and 37%, averages 12 points. You won't hear me say a lick about him. You won't hear me say nothing about him.
I agree. If this game goes down, this efficiency goes up, I would love that. I seriously would. With this team, yeah.
He shoots, what does he shoot here? He shoots 40% from the field, which is trash. He only averages 12 points a game. He's 3 rebounds a game. I mean, you know who averages more rebounds a game? Brandon Jennings. Like, this is like, I'm just, all I'm saying is that, like, he needs to average 17, 18 points a game, because honestly, like, stats like this is something that I expect Stanley Johnson to have his first year. Stanley Johnson's first year there, I think he's going to be a 12-point scorer. And I think he probably will shoot 40% his first year. But I also think he'll play in limited minutes as well. KCP, 31 minutes a game. Started every single game. 31 minutes a game.
How many shots did he take again?
Total shots, 12 shots again. 12 shots, 12 points.
That's what I'm saying. That's hot. That's not efficiency out of your shooting guard.
No, that's not going to get it done, buddy.
My thing for him, my long-term thing for KCP would be, like, I'm okay with, like, if he doesn't score, like, a ton of points, I'm all right with that. But that shoot percent goes up because Danny Green doesn't average a lot of points, but he's a threat from that arc. So when he comes up that floor, they have to come out. They have to come out.
Yeah.
Now, if KCP has a hot game, they'll get up on him. But if he starts off cold, they know he's going to end cold. They're like, it's his trademark. If he starts hot, he's going to have a good game. If he starts cold, his game will be cold. You cannot be a team saying this is my starting shooting guard, and when we
right.
when he's and he gets some good looks, and he was getting some good looks. Like,
yeah, he was.
I'm telling you, his release looks great. Everything looks great. His release is great. His form looks good. But he just didn't really be off. He really be missing. And that's my concern. Like, when you're trying to build a championship team, off of three-point shooting, you're trying to build a championship team off of this, you know, this one-score type thing where you're going to be, Drummond's going to be the centerpiece.
Ha! 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 Dude, KCP does not fit this system, man. This system that everybody claims that we're building, like KCP is like the main suspect guy, and we're trying to build a system around this kind of shooting guard. Right.
No.
Right.
It's my concern.
Yeah. It's a matter of concern. Like you have to get better. Like that's it. Make a break, man. It's make a break,
yeah.
KCP. That's
yeah. It definitely make a break. And like I said, I'm not saying he can't get better. We've seen guys get better. I mean, we've seen guys go to the D League and come back and they really contribute this. And I believe once again, I believe he's an above average defender. I believe he's above average defender, too good defender, above average, too good defender. And he hustles. He plays hard. He plays hard. I give his intangibles. A hustle, play hard like a 10. If it was just off a hustle, play hard, don't take no plays off, he'd be a 10. He'd be like a superstar, but it just doesn't end there. It's that consistency, and I think even fans said, like, maybe he was playing too many minutes. So maybe his role, he'd be better. If he was better served coming off the bench, he may be better served coming off the bench. When he could come in, and he'd be like a heat check type dude, like J.R. Smith.
Yep.
Like, people like to compare people to J.R. Smith, but J.R. Smith has some good years in Denver. He has some, but J.R. Smith can actually score. He can just beat his man off the dribble. But J.R. Smith, he has some good, as a heat check guy who can come off the bench for about 25 minutes, and if he's hot, hit like 6 threes, and just that's his role. Even Jamal Crawford, although Jamal Crawford wasn't even better ball handler than everything, but these are heat check guys who can come off the bench, score, shoot, and everything. So I'm just looking for KCP consistency. If he becomes consistent, I'll ride with him. If he's not consistent, I'm not just going to ride with him because he's a Piston and we should just ride behind Piston fans. No, that kid got us in trouble with Austin Day. Like, people, like you said, like Merlin said, we was looking at Austin Day like, oh, he had a great summer league. Oh, you remember that game 3 games ago he hit this? I remember that game Austin Day had a great, and we all thought he was breaking through. Then he goes right back to the way he was. I can't keep on riding with guys like that. I mean, I want to win, but I can't keep on riding with guys like that.
My problem with Austin Day, my problem with Austin Day was that he had some serious matchup problems. Well, the other team had serious matchup problems with him in summer league because he was playing power forward, man, the whole summer league. I remember that. He was playing all power forward, and he was just stretching the floor, man. A lot of the power forwards that are playing summer league are not meant to chase guys out to the perimeter. I mean, he was just destroying guys, man. Just off the mismatches. But I also
sorry,
want
guys, I'm in my car, you can hear some rain, just so you know.
I did want to point out this though. Did you know KCP shot 69% from the free throw line?
I did, and
that's what I'm saying.
I did not know he was out of a
if you want to round it up, he's at right about 70, but that's not good for a shooting guard. That's what I'm trying to say.
It's horrible. It's horrible.
He actually performed. His average from his average per game from his rookie year, which he averaged just under 20 minutes a game, is right on par with what he averaged at 31 minutes a game. Like there's literally no big significance other than the shots he attempted. All the shots that he attempted went up, but all of his averages are about the same.
Wow.
He's a little bit better than
yeah,
me, for sure. I don't know, man. He's one of those guys that that we're going to have to keep an eye on if Stan Van Gundy's not going to keep an eye on him.
Yeah, he doesn't have a lot of wiggle room, is just what I'm saying. Like, he doesn't have a lot of wiggle room, man. He doesn't.
He gotta come off this season ready to do something.
You know, somebody said something to me. I was reading about our boy Stanley Johnson. Hold on, guys. I'm gonna try to make it as I just pulled it up to my house and it's raining. So hold up. Hey guys, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, I got you. Hello? Yeah. Man, my phone got wet.
Yeah, so Yeah. So KCP's gotta pick it up, man. He's one of these guys that we're gonna have to keep an eye on big time. What bothers me, man, about him is that he brings nothing to the table besides a big body at shooting guard, and he's above average defense. I really don't think he's that great a defender. He's all right. He's an okay defender.
Yep.
I'm sorry. They were talking about the guy Hillard. And Stanley Johnson said that him and Hillard are going to be getting, like, talking about moving in together. And when he said that, I was like, that's crazy because, like, how do you figure that Hillard's going to be, like, a long-term, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Solution. So I wonder, did somebody give like, Hillard any type of, like, vote of confidence that you're going to be on the team, you know, for him to say that? Or was that just Stanley Johnson being young? And it's like, oh, I like this guy, and we're gonna move in together. Like we're gonna share a place or whatever. But, I mean, I'm just looking at that. Like, I just think that if you look at the guy Hillard, he's already. I mean, him and KCP are the same age. I like that 22, but he's more advanced than KCP because he can dribble. He can score off the dribble. KCP can't do that.
I think he might be taller than KCP because he looks as tall as Stanley Johnson, to be honest with you.
Yeah, he's 6'7". Yeah, he's 6'7". He's 6'7". KCP is, you know, 6'5 and a half or however you want to roll with it. But that's what I'm trying to say. Like, he already brings something that KCP doesn't. And they're the same type of player. They're just volume shooters. They're volume shooters, but he can dribble and get his – he can actually score off the bounce. He has an in-between game. That's something that KCP has never developed. Now, that's the thing that sometimes when guys jump from college to NBA, you don't get a chance to really develop your game the way you would want to develop a game. So all of a sudden, you come to the NBA, and you have to do something right now really well, or you're not valuable to a team. So you don't have that learning time to, okay, I'm going to learn how to dribble now. You can't just do that during game time and teams are, you know, and you thinking, oh, well, I need to make this roster, so I got to shoot. I got to do this. This is Bob Gere. And I think that even that guy, just watching him, he looks more physically. He has this good physique to him. And I think he's like, if I'm correct, and I could be off, I think he was like, they're saying 6'7", 215, 220. And I'm not saying KCP has gotten bigger, but KCP was 6'5", maybe 205, 210. See, he's already physically bigger. He already has, you know, he's already just a physically bigger guy, but he brings in more skill. Now, I'm not saying he's better than KCP, but I'm just saying he already brings a certain skill level a little bit higher. I just think KCP just going to have, I think he's going to have some competition this year. I really do. I think he's going to have some real competition this year.
Yeah, he's
going to. I hope it drives him. I hope it drives him to be really great, to make him want to do great things. I really do. I hope he's a guy who can handle pressure, but if not, I don't know, man. I don't know.
What would happen to, like, a lot of these guys?
Our phone's about to die, man. It's a pleasure to talk to you guys again, man. I'll get you guys soon, all right?
All right, man. Hey, right. Appreciate it, Edwin. Take it easy, man.
Yeah, take it easy, guys.
Absolutely, man. Have a good night.
You too.
Thank you. All right, so, I was going to say, man, I wish a lot more guys would shoot more mid-range jump shots. Just because, yeah. I mean, I like, what's really caught my attention as of late is jump shots attempted during the mid-range game as opposed to the three-point range game. And just so many more guys just shoot so much better, just like a foot or two inside the three-point line as opposed to just stretching it out to the three-point line. I mean, these guys' numbers skyrocket. Problem is that their attempts from inside the perimeter are so low that it's hard to get a real gauge of how well they shoot it. And KCP's one of those guys. Now, he's not shooting it great just inside the three-point line, but he shoots it pretty, it's probably his best-looking shot from 10 to 16 feet. But he doesn't shoot it at all from 10 to 16 feet. It's one of the lower percentages of attempts that he takes. And it's like, dude, I mean, all we're looking for you is to put up points and numbers. You know what I mean? And just, like, take advantage of your best shot is what I'm saying. You know what I mean? That's, like, what I'm saying is that's what Rip Hamilton did his whole career. That's what Rip Hamilton did his whole career, is he just took advantage of the best shot he knew how to take, and he put up points and numbers. He wasn't worried about stretching out the perimeter. He wasn't worried about stretching out defenses. He was just worried about getting his points and getting them in numbers. And that's what you need from a shooting guard, man, in my opinion. That's what you need from a shooting guard.
But do you think that's more about the trend of the NBA versus, I think that's more the NBA trend than it's been more so about, I'm just saying, I like the Pistons or KCP. I think the NBA trend and just the whole efficiency thing said, instead of taking a step inside the three-point line, where you will go from, let's just say, you know, 37% three-point shooter, but when you step the foot in, you're 43% jump shooter from that distance, or closer, probably close to 42%. You better off taking a three, because of, you know, the points and the efficiency of a three-point, like, you know, they say a three-point shot is the most efficient shot, like, as far as putting points up versus the two-pointer. So I think that's more of the trend of the NBA. And, you know, really, Stan Van Gundy is one of the people who started it. You know,
I agree that's the trend of the NBA. But at the same time, what would be more efficient, man? A guy that's, like, shooting 40%? Or what was it? Let me look at this again. What would be more efficient, though? A guy that's shooting 34% from three, or a guy that's shooting 43% from 16 feet?
No, I agree with you. Like I said, I think it's more the trend in the NBA to say, and the culture to say, take the three-pointer versus take the 24-footer instead of the 20-footer. And even though you may, you know, make the 20, you know, you'll make the 24-footer less, it's worth more, and it opens the floor up more versus the 20-footer, when it's going to cause defenses to be able to sag back into the lanes, and it's just worth two. I just think it's a trend, and I think that you can break a trend, though. And I think if KCP, I'm not saying he has Rip Hamilton's skill, because Rip Hamilton, he really didn't have a skill, and you don't really see other players even play like him, but he has a Rip, you know. But Rip Hamilton had a skill of efficiency. But if you notice towards the end of Rip Hamilton's career, what was he doing a lot of?
He was shooting the three. Yeah, he was shooting the three with his little flame armband. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
His shooting sleeve with a flame on it?
Yeah, I remember that. He was one of the pictures, too, that ended his career in such a way that it didn't make me happy, but I can deal with Rip a little bit more than I can deal with Tayshaun. Those are two Pistons who just kind of disappointed me with the way they ended their career.
Oh, yeah, you too? Me as well, man. I was not happy with either one of them, man. I mean, I know Ben Wallace really burned a lot of people's asses about his move to Chicago. But, like, I think Tayshaun and Rip Hamilton sting me a little bit more, just because they stuck around and they didn't do much in the leadership role that was given to them.
Yes. I think my big thing for KCP was, Rip, and not to get off subject, but my big thing for Rip is, like, and Tayshaun, Like, and this is where Joe Dumars could have, and people trash Joe Dumars, but Joe Dumars is a loyal guy. He's always been this loyal guy. I'll go back a little bit further. You may remember it. You remember when he had got Judd Butchler? It was like a while ago.
Who, Joe Dumars?
Joe Dumars. Yeah, when he got him from the Bulls. He signed him from the Bulls.
I thought that was I thought him and Joe played together. You sure that was Judd that you're talking about? I thought him and Joe played together when they were in the Pistons. This is right before he retired.
No, I think it was after.
Okay.
Go
ahead.
But no, I just remember they were talking about Joe Dumars had made a promise to Judd Butchler. Like, he had made this promise to Judd Butchler that he was going to take care of him, that he was going to re-sign him. And everybody's like, oh, Judd Butchler didn't produce, but he re-signed him. And I think Joe Dumars just always just, signed him. I can't remember the story, but I remember there was this promise that he made with him, and he kept his promise. And it's like, I think Joe Dumars is a loyal guy. Like, he wants to take care of his own. And I think he took care of Rip Hamilton, and he took care of Tayshaun Prince, and I think they both stabbed him in the back, and I really do. I don't care. I'm sorry. I know that he moved Chauncey Billups, and I know that he made this move for Iverson, and everybody hates it, but Iverson had a really good year just, you know, in Denver. He wasn't like Iverson was just like this garbage player, and Iverson had a really good year in Denver, and he just didn't work out in Detroit. But then for Tayshaun Prince, you were supposed to be, we were looking for you to become our leader anyway. We were looking for you to be the next leader of the Pistons, like our next guy, go-to guy. You never stepped up. And then Rip, you know, you kept on saying you was the man, you wanted to be respected. You wanted to be respected as one of the top shooting guards in the league. And and you had the opportunity, and then you didn't step up. But then, so then they started this mutiny. This whole mutiny, get coaches, and all this discord in the team.
Yep.
I remember the newspapers talking about how bad an organization the Pistons were. And it's all starting from those two.
Yeah.
And, you know, just about our attitudes and the players don't listen. And it started because of those two. And it took a long time for that reputation to change. So I'm always going to have like a sour spot about those two players.
Dude, the way you describe that, about Rip and Tayshaun is the exact sentiment that I've had about them since they've left. You know what I mean? And it was one of the main reasons why I was not real happy about them bringing back Tayshaun during the season. I'm like, why? Why bring him back?
Right.
You know what I mean? There was a reason why he left. You know what I mean? And it was not on good terms, man. I really agree with you, like 110%, because this is exactly the way I felt. And that was funny that you say that about Riff, because he was ready to step up and be the man at the guard, you know, position. But you know what he did?
Mm-hmm.
You know what he did? He bitched and moaned about them trading away his boy pal. You know what I mean? He bitched
right.
and moaned about it. He bitched and moaned about it. And then not only that, the one thing I do sympathize for him is that when they did trade him away, they traded him away for another shooting guard. they traded him away for Allen Iverson. So, like, he had to share minutes at shooting guard with Allen Iverson. And then you had a shooting guard playing point guard, which was Rodney Stuckey. So I really do feel bad for him on that end. But he was butthurt about them trading away his boy, and it's like, dude, I mean, like, I thought you were ready to step up and be the man. You know what I mean? Right? Right? Like, I agree with you.
I think he could have made an impact on the Pistons, even if his attitude was different. I remember it was even interviewing about how bad he felt when Chauncey left. So it's like, and I get all of that, but you're a professional. You're supposed to be a professional. And at some point, you know this is the NBA, you know how this business goes, you know that you could be here today and gone tomorrow and everything like that. You're like, oh, Joe Dumars didn't call me here, let me know. You know how many players who are superstars who don't have a say in what the team does and what the team doesn't do, and you think that Joe Dumont has to come and sit down with you and tell you, hey, we're going to – he already knows what you're going to say. He already knows you're not going to like it. So, you know, it just – and he probably already knew your attitude, and you probably would have been even worse. So I just think that Joe Dumont gets so much slack for the move. It's terrible that obviously didn't work out. I wish we had kept Chauncey. I wish we had kept that team together. But it's not like we just got rid of everybody. We kept two people who were younger, and we looked at them as potentially leaders, and they just totally went against everything. It was like little girls. They were like little whiny girls, like was a gossip girl stuff. Like they were caught all type of discord. I would never respect them for that stage. I respect them for the championship and the hard work. But then they got paid and acting like that. Like they got paid. Like,
yeah.
You got contracts there. People was like, they should not give Rip Hamilton that contract.
Oh, and didn't he get that contract right after Chauncey got traded or right before he got traded?
That's what I'm saying. He didn't take away that money. Yeah. He didn't say, no, I don't want that money. You took the money.
He definitely acted up.
Like, and same thing with Tayshaun Prince. Like, we gave you the contract. We signed Tayshaun Prince. We gave him the extension. When everybody was like, oh, the Pistons are probably not going to re-sign Tayshaun Prince. We came back and gave Tayshaun Prince a good contract.
Yep.
A good one.
Yep.
And for that time, like that $8 million, like, that was a good contract back then.
Yep.
And you come back and you don't even, put in any work. Like, Tayshaun Prince never got better.
Never
got better.
Actually declined. I mean, like, I would say, like, post 2010, man, was his decline, man. Like, he never got better, and he never got better with his attitude, man. Like,
I thank him for the championship. I thank him for the hard work.
You remember the 2004 days, 2005 days when we were the top team, we were the top dog in the NBA, right? And You remember Tayshaun Prince, how young he was during that time? He was like 24. Like, he was the baby of that team. And you're like, man, all these guys are 27, 28. You know what I mean? All these guys are in their older 20s. You know, they got a little direction in their life and in their basketball careers. And, you know, they're leading the team. But, man, just imagine what we're building, because Tayshaun Prince is surrounded by all this. And he's 24 years old, already won a championship. Just imagine what this is going to do when all these guys have moved on and now it's Tayshaun's team. You remember people talking about
I remember.
It went in the opposite fucking direction. Opposite direction with Tayshaun. What's that, Dickie?
Unfortunately, I wasn't a part of the whole championship era of and I apologize. I did not experience that. I heard they won. I'm very happy. And I thought Ben Wallace was amazing. But, okay, I don't know. No. But, like, when I got into it, it was around 2006 or 2007. That was shit. That was absolutely – I mean, I only got into it because my 83-year-old grandmother is, like, the most hardcore Pistons fan you will ever meet.
Nice.
And so it just slowly, I took her to a game. It slowly started to get it to me. But during those 3 years, I have never seen such lackluster coaching, lackluster playing, lackluster everything. I don't know what our record was. Like, it could not have been good. It could not have been, because it was just, I don't know what Tayshaun was thinking, but he's probably thinking, this is bullshit. Every day, this is bullshit. I remember in the palace, they had this huge balloon that would float around. It was this big mechanized horse that just floated around. And I'm like, what the fuck? Is this a carnival? Like, what is going on in his? Like, it was such a joke. And I'm not saying, like, he should have handled it better, because he was, at this point now, he is the veteran. But I swear to God, when we traded him, and everybody was devastated in 2010? They're like, or 2011, 2000, whatever. And everybody was like, oh my God, no, Tayshaun, what the? And they interviewed me. He's like, yeah, well, you know, these things happen. And I'm just like, you want to leave, don't you? You so want to leave. You don't want to be back here. Because all of the great memories that you had when you first started, they're gone. nothing has really happened since. The team that I met when I first got into basketball, that was awful. I don't even know how we still hung around, but we still did. But when they brought him back, why would you bring him back? It was such a sour thing. I mean, I guess for like sentimental, we have Tayshaun back. I'm like, so what? He hated it here. I could tell. The guy was just like, oh well. I'm going to a contender. You guys are not contenders. I want to be a contender. Understood. We're not getting there. So he left. But I could tell he's going to get, like, there was a trace of a smile on his face when he was like, with everybody
had
like cameras
on.
He was ecstatic. He was like, I'm going to go to the playoffs. You guys are still going to be here. And I just think he wants to leave. He wants to leave. He so wants to leave. And I was kind of, when they announced he was coming back, I was like, that's so not. I mean, it's not even like, yay, it's like, oh, we're going to do this again? I don't know. Like, I think we should just, like, cut ties and just, like, let that go. I don't know. What is he doing now? Is he still with the Pistons, or is he, like, did he?
No, he's not. He's talking about him signing with Cleveland.
Yeah, he's.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he's gone. He's not coming back. I don't want him back. That was one of the things that bothered me about bringing him back last year. Is that I just didn't want him back, one, because of how he left, but two, I want to remember him how I remember the championship team. You know what I mean? I don't want to open up old wounds. You know what I mean? Like, Rick Hamilton was available because he was in free agency, and I was like, no, I'm good. I don't want him back either. Like, I'm good with Rip Hamilton retiring because now I can savor the moments that he came in and just was whooping on Dwayne Wade and Ray Allen and just everybody else that was in the East at the time and Reggie Miller, you know what I mean? And same with Tayshaun. It's like, I just don't want her. I didn't want you back on the team. I just want you to just go far away, retire, so I can just remember for all the good times that we had and just be done with
it. The era was over. And, like, let's just cut this off and let's just go our separate ways because we're not making you happy anymore. It was so obvious. I'm like, this guy wants to go. I mean, like, he's like, oh, well, too bad, guys. I mean, he was almost just like, oh, I think my flight's right here. Can we get these microphones on my face? She was just very like, I don't care.
You know, undercover, Tayshaun Prince was, like, trying to force his way out of Detroit. He was trying to get out of Detroit. When, you know, they started, and I think part of it was, and this is my little conspiracy theory about Tayshaun Prince. I think he knew that he really didn't have a ceiling. He already knew his ceiling, right? When everybody was talking about the potential of, you know, this team is going to be in, like you said, Mike, this team is going to be in good hands with Tayshaun Prince. This team is going to be, I think he knew that he already met his ceiling. He knew he was going to be the best, I think with his best season, like 14 or 15 points. He knew that was the best he'll ever be. He knew it.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew that as they start to take away Rip, as they start to take away Ben, he can't carry a team. And then even when he went to, like, Memphis, he was garbage at Memphis. You did all of that. Oh, I want to play for a championship team. You did. You went to Memphis. That's when they were very, very good. They had a lot of work to keep, just all this type of stuff. And he was really no more than just a sixth man. He was a sixth man on a good team.
Right.
You know, at best.
Right.
You know, so I was one of the people, when I heard Tayshaun Prince got traded, I was like, yes.
So
I wasn't like, oh, man. I was like, yes. I was like, this should have happened 2 years ago.
Right.
We should have never resigned him.
Right.
We should have never resigned him.
Right.
So I had a totally different feel about him.
To piggyback off that, Elda, just to come in Tayshaun's defense a little bit on that, is that I agree with you. Once he started seeing some of the pieces go away, he knew that his ceiling was limited. But I think everybody knew Tayshaun's ceiling was limited. I think there may have been a few select people that thought, like, oh, like, yeah, if everybody just, like, kind of parted ways, he'd be a 20-point scorer. But I think for the most part, everybody knew that he was a limited player to begin with on offense. I think what it was is that he just brought that defense, you know what I mean? I mean, there's not too many people that I know that shut down so many star wing swingman players back in the early 2000s like Tayshaun did. And I think that was the big thing that he brought. But my thing is, though, about Tayshaun that I wanted to come to his defense about was that if you think about it, from the time he was drafted to the time the team got taken apart, he played playoff games alone, like almost like two more seasons worth of playoff games. Think about that. Think about how many playoff games he played from the moment he was drafted to the moment the Pistons stopped going to the playoffs. He played a ton of playoff games, man. We were going deep in the playoffs almost every single year that he was in a Pistons uniform. My point is that legs get tired faster, man. All that shit wears down on you.
Yeah.
And you know, like he was supposed to be a 28-year-old player when everybody got taken away, but he was really playing with like coming in Tayshaun's defense, it's just my opinion, but he possibly could have been playing with a 32-year-old body, man, just for how much wear and tear he took during those years.
I mean, my thing is this, and I know we've gone left with this conversation, but it's good, but I think that my thing about Tayshaun Prince, once again, I know what he went through. And it's like somebody said the same thing about Jordan. Like, really? Like, people don't. Like, they said, when you really go into the analytics on Jordan and what he's done, like, you know that Jordan went to the playoffs. Like, after that, whatever was after, yeah, they beat the Pistons. They literally went deep into the playoffs, into the finals.
Yeah.
Almost like 6 years, 9 years, time of year. So, really, Jordan has played really like a whole another season of playoff games. Just like I said, like,
right.
LeBron now, like, LeBron is a whole another season.
Right.
My whole thing about Tayshaun Prince is not that what he contributed up to the championship. It's when the team started to just, it felt like unappreciative. It's like.
Right, I agree. That I do agree with.
Thank you. Yeah, we thank you for what you did. It's because of what you did. Not because we think you have this super duper ceiling. Not because we think you're going to be a superstar. Not because we think you're going to be awesome. But just thank you. We're going to give you this fat contract. You take the fat contract, and then all of a sudden you be like, I want out. I'm going to act like it. I don't think that Cooster was, like, the greatest coach ever, but he literally formed a mutiny against him. You know,
right.
He let him and Rip Hamilton actually conspire against the coach.
Right.
To make all those young players, and they looking at that, like, even Greg Monroe. I remember, like, I'm like, dang, that has to be terrible for guys.
Exactly.
This is an introduction into the NBA is the two championship guys, and they are acting like, you know, like little kids, like they're the worst, like they're being the worst, and they're actually conspiring, like getting, you know, people to sit out games. We had Tracy McGrady on, like these are veterans,
yep.
And they're all just literally conspiring against the coach. And even started the back, I mean, it was like all of them a little bit. But even flips on this, like Detroit Pistons, and I said this, I love my Pistons, I'm ready, and thank you for the championships and the great memories. Somewhere we just got this ego, where we went from this underdog, this likable underdog, to these like unlikable egos. So even flips on this, like flips on this was a good coach during that time period. He was like one of the most winning coaches, active winning coaches. In
my personal opinion, okay. I don't mean to cut you off, Eldo, but my personal opinion, Flip Saunders made Rip Hamilton relevant, in my opinion. He made Rip Hamilton very, 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 very relevant. Like,
he got better with him.
Yeah, he got a lot better with him. Like, in those.
He made him a fashion of the offense.
In the Larry Brown era. I really felt like out of the starting five, Rip Hamilton was probably the most expendable. Was the most expendable out of the starting five. And then, but when Flip Saunders came into town, things changed a little bit. Things did change a little bit.
Have you noticed, Flip Saunders, he took and he put the ball in Rip Hamilton's hand a little bit more. He gave Rip Hamilton the confidence shoot, but I felt like Rip and the Pistons, they just trashed the man. Like,
yep.
We were, like, still winning 55, 60 games or whatever it was. We were still winning. And they acted like it was his fault that you ran up against LeBron. Like,
yep.
LeBron was just LeBron. Like,
Do you remember the comment? Do you remember the comment that Rasheed Wallace made about Flip Saunders? Do you remember that?
No, wait a minute.
He said something like, this is around the time Flip Saunders was on his way out the door. Okay, so this he might have had one season left before he was done. And the thing about those, Rasheed Wallace came out and said, like, we run our own team. We don't really need much of a coach. And again, this isn't my words, but I'm trying to paraphrase what he basically said. But this is a direct quote about what he said. The things I just said were kind of paraphrased about what he said, but this is a direct quote of what he said. He's like, with Flip Saunders, it's kind of like spilling a cup of coffee on a person on purpose and the person just not doing nothing about it, and he just kind of brushes it off, and that's kind of how we feel about Flip Saunders. That's pretty much what the fuck he said. It was the spilling of the coffee comment. I don't know if anybody remember that comment. It was really weird that he said that, but it was one of those things, because if you guys remember, like, that team really did run the show. If they didn't like somebody, they came together and they were like, yeah, we don't like you. You know what I mean? Like, it's one of those things. It's like, I really feel you on that whole thing about us being underdogs, us being a real gritty team. But after we reached that gold, you know what I mean? We got a little bit prima donna-ish. Actually, we got a lot of prima donna-ish. Big time. Absolutely.
I think the worst thing that happened was, like, us beating the Lakers. Because that just put us in the... I think we had beat the Spurs first. I think, and then we came back, and then the next year we would have beat the Lakers like, yeah. I think we lost to the Spurs out of a lot of our ego and just thinking that we were better than the Spurs and that we were just going to, you know, click that light switch and it was just going to happen. I think we just had so much ego. Not that ego, they couldn't play together, but, like, really just arrogance, like, maybe arrogance is a better word. Like, we're really better than them. And we're going to get back to this game 7 or game 6 or whatever it is, and we're going to win, and we're going to, you know, I heard Chauncey say it one time, like, we just flipped the switch.
Right.
Like, he used to say that, like,
right.
You know, sometimes they're like, oh, how do you come back from these 10 points? Yeah, we just flipped the switch. Yeah, we know when it's game time, and, you know, we know the most important quarter is to win. It's a fourth quarter. That's not how they were when they went in that championship.
Yeah.
They grinded
out.
From beginning to end, the Pistons had, like, one of the highest win percent margins of, like, all teams. They was, like, beating teams by, like, 17, 18 points, holding them to under 70 points a game.
Right.
So I just think that it was just something that kind of changed with the team. So then as Chauncey left, and Chauncey is probably the most well mentally. Now, looking at all the Pistons now, Chauncey probably was like the brainiac who really kept that team together.
Right.
Because when they removed him, everybody just seemed like, it was like, they didn't know how to function without him. Like,
right.
Oh, I want money. Oh, I want my fame. Like, Ben Wallace even getting so arrogant. Like, even Ben Wallace got arrogant. Like, you know, all of a sudden he wanted to be shooting jumpers and he wanted to show that he's an offensive player. No, Ben.
I to come to Ben Wallace's defense on that, again, that was Flip Saunders, dude. Like, Flip Saunders brought the offensive player out of everybody, man. I really felt like that. I feel like that's a lot of Flip Saunders doing, everything that you just said about Ben Wallace. I think that was a lot of Flip Saunders doing. I think that was one of the main reasons why he left. Is that Ben didn't want to transition to be an offensive player. He knew that was not his game, and he knew that this team would move on without him if he didn't become an offensive player. I really felt like...
He wanted that money.
Huh? And he wanted the money. And he wanted the money. But do you remember...
Pistons wasn't going to pay Ben Wallace all of that money.
No.
Knowing that he was on the last bit of his career.
True.
And then they gave him a nice little contract.
They did give him a nice contract.
And that was the best, I'll tell you this, that was the best move that Joe Dumars did not make in re-signing Ben Wallace to a long
contract for the money that he was getting. That was ridiculous.
The sad part about that is Ben had 1.5 good years left in him, and then he broke. Mm-hmm. Then he broke his leg. I don't know if you guys remember that. He actually broke his leg.
That.
So it's like, yeah, man, I that was one of the best moves. In hindsight, that was one of the best moves that Joe Dumars
and
did.
And we still took him back. Like, we literally taking dudes back, and we took Joshua back. We kept Rashid and put them up. Like, the Pistons have been a loyal, like, Joe Dumars did everything he did
yes.
for those players. Like,
yes.
Right. Like, he just kept bringing guys back.
Right.
It was even, like, rumored for a little while that maybe Rip would be coming back. But I just think Rip burned so many bridges. Like, Rip was, like, trashing the team even when he left, like verbally, like, really trashing the team. But literally, he burnt every bridge. But, like, he brought Chauncey back. We were talking about Chauncey being a VP, you know, like, being, like, in a, you know, in that office. And he brought back Rasheed. Rasheed went into coaching. Bray brought back Ben for his little, you know, retirement tour. You know, he brought back, you know, he didn't bring back Tayshaun France. So he probably would have brought back Tayshaun France.
Probably would have.
Like, the Pistons has always been, like, a really good organization for taking care of players. Like, even, I would say this, even with, had nothing to do with Greg Monroe, but kind of did. Like, Joe Dumars, he could have potentially had moved Greg Monroe sooner. But he really believed that Greg Monroe was going to be a long-term answer. Like, nobody could really see, and I'm defending Joe Dumars, nobody could really see that Drummond was going to fall number 9 in draft. Like, nobody could see that. Nobody saw that coming. Nobody saw that coming. Well, I'll tell the truth, Joe Dumars saw that coming. Because if you look at the report, there was a report that said they found out that Drummond could potentially be slipping. So, Joe Dumars called Drummond's agent, or Drummond's agent called Joe Dumars. And so Joe Dumars had flew up to New York or something like that and got Drummond in a late-night workout. And they just ran through some things because Drummond did not come to the Pistons for a workout. And he told him, I can't remember, I want to say it went like this. I want to say that Joe Dumars had heard that Drummond could be slipping. He reached out to Drummond's agent and said, hey, you know, Drummond could be slipping. And we're not, and the only way we'll pass on him if we can't get a workout. We just want to see the kid. So then Joe Dumars sets up like this late night workout with Drummond. You know, they do bring his rebounding coaches and his shooting coaches and his big man coaches. They all come out that night and they run Drummond through these drills and his athleticism blows him out the water, the rebounding and all the stuff around the basket. And then they decide to take him. Joe Dumars has this wonderful eye for talent. He really did. Like, if you look at the pieces he put together, even though, you know, okay, yeah, we could have had Paul George instead of Greg Monroe, we could have had this person. But literally, Drummond, Greg Monroe, and I'm talking about lottery picks. Drummond, Greg Monroe,
KCP,
Brandon Knight. KCP. If we had kept that core together, well, right now, look like Brandon. I'm talking about coaching. I've been coaching effective Brandon Knight. But if you look at Brandon Knight, he is a potential all-star this year. You look at Greg Monroe. Greg Monroe is a guy who people are calling an all-star quality big man. You look at Drummond. He's on a verge, depending on that little hook shot, he's on a verge of becoming like an all-star quality big man, considered like a top 3 best big man in the league. And then KCP, depending on how you feel about him, you know, a solid shooting guard. He really almost put together a starting lineup just through the draft.
Yeah.
You know, and he's messed up by trading the pick for Corey McGetty and everything like that. Who knows who we would have drafted in that draft and everything like that. But, I mean, he did a good job, man. He had an eye for talent, man. He really did have an eye for talent. He messed up on Roddy White and he messed up on Darko. And he admitted those. But you look outside of that, and the team Cleaves, but I think that was, he was early. You know, that was early in his
All of those were technically early, man. Even Darko, dude. A lot of people give him shit about Darko, but that was like his third year managing. Like literally every person that you named were like all early in his career. So it's like as a general manager. So like. I don't know, man. I do agree with you in a lot of things. Do you remember Ronnie Stuckey in his interview he had, like, over the summer, this not this summer, but the past summer when he was going to the Pacers, he said something about, like, he had a bunch of guys holding him down, and that there was people that were, like, spreading bad rumors about him inside the organization. I mean, do you want to take a wild fucking guess who do you think that was? Because, like, I know who that was. And I'm just like, yeah, of course, man, because you took his buddy's spot, dude. Like, you were, I feel, like, I sympathize for Rodney. I know a lot of people give Rodney shit, but I sympathize for Rodney because Rodney fucking got the bad end of the fucking deal, bro. And that was another guy. That was another guy Joe Dumars drafted. Another guy Joe Dumars drafted. And it's like, and he was solid. For, what was he, a 15th pick? He was a 14th pick? He was solid, man.
Yeah, solid.
And my point is like, dude, like, you were set up from the go, man. Like, I really feel bad for you, man, that you had to come in through all this bullshit. Like, you mentioned, like, Greg Monroe, like, he had to put up all this other shit in his rookie year. But fucking Rodney Stuckey, dude. Rodney,
he had it
bad, man. Like,
once again, if you look at Rodney Stuckey, like, his numbers, he had one year where he had, like, he hit this really good place. Now, he's a guy who met his ceiling at about that 16, 15 points per game, six assists, or whatever.
Yeah.
And that may have been his ceiling. But he was, like, but what happened to him was, if he was just a regular 14 pick on any other team, he would be considered, like, a good pick. You know, you were the 14th pick who came in and was considered a replacement for Chauncey Billups, who's, like, a legend. You know what I mean? Who became, like, a Pistons, like, legend, like, a god-like type thing where nothing can do it wrong, and you never became that. And I think that's the part where if Chauncey Billups had embraced him, had Rip Hamlin, they never embraced these young guys. Like, they didn't embrace Darko. They didn't.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. You're right about that.
Darko. You know, who knows what. And I'll say this, and people are like, oh, Darko, yep, Darko was a bust. You're not going by. Darko was an 18-year-old. Darko just turned 18.
Yep.
He was 17 before the draft because they wanted him to be able to be legal for the draft. He had to be 18. He was like 18. I think his birthday is like on the day before the draft or draft night or something. He's literally 18 on draft night. He's coming from a war-torn country. He gets to America, and he's met by this Piston team that's rejecting him, that's like, you should have drafted Melo. And and they're like, they treat him like garbage. They're laughing at him, making fun of him in the bench. You know, they're probably punking him in workouts. They're probably doing all type of crazy stuff to him. Then you come with a coach who pretty much like, we should have drafted Melo. And then doing the same thing. Like, his psyche had to be destroyed. Like, we just assume.
Let me add the little cherry on top of all that, because you're right. All that fuck. Remember, he's 18 years old, man. He's 18 year old fucking kid. 18. Think about that. Think about how you were when you're 18 years old. I mean, right. Just turning 18. You're 17 a second ago. But my point is like, to add on to the psyche, what are the newspapers calling you? You open up a new
cigar.
The human fucking victory cigar. You were the fucking second round draft pick just behind LeBron James. LeBron James is considered the hero in fucking Cleveland and the next big thing in the NBA. And what are you called? You're the fucking laughing stock by the human victory cigar. We got a championship.
And then you watching all you got, the other you got, rookies this
yeah.
playing time. And you got every other rookie. I'm talking about every other rookie up to the lottery. I'm talking about every other rookie in the lottery. I'm not just saying like Bosch or anything. Like every Kurt Heinrich, all of them guys.
Chris Kamen. Chris Kamen, David West. I mean, just everybody that came out. Everybody.
At the end of the bench.
Oh, literally, almost every single player in the first round found them a spot in the roster rotation almost immediately. If not in their first year, definitely their second and third year. You know what I mean? And what is Darko doing? Darko's sitting at the end of the bench because he's got fucking... Yeah, getting called a bust. Dude, Darko had it rough too. It was definitely fucking with him.
Yeah, like I said, that whole era was just like bad. If you was a rookie, it was just like the worst era to be a Pistons. Like it was just a terrible era. I don't know how good Darko could have been, and you know we could accuse him, but I just feel like his psyche got destroyed. It took him forever to build back up, and then teams was like, well, you know, we don't care no more. But I just think that his psyche was destroyed as like a young man, like 18 years old. His whole family wasn't even here yet. Like, you're in a foreign country. You just learned to speak English. Your teammates are dumping you out. I never heard Chauncey Billups once say, like, old Ben Wallace say, you know, yeah, we've been taken up on our wing. They would say things like, yeah, he has a lot to learn. You know, we beat up on him a little bit. You know, he's a little soft. We try to toughen him up. Those are the comments that you hear, like, oh, he's a little soft. We're going to toughen him up. You know, yeah, he has to earn some starting minutes. Like, you lose a minute to Darvin Ham. Like, Darvin Ham is getting your minutes. Like, you know what I mean? It was just, I feel bad for Darko. And I, like I said, I just wonder how Darko would have been had he got drafted on any other team. And they said, you know what, Darko, we trust you. We believe in you. And we're going to, you know, put you in these positions. We're going to play your game.
You know what,
bro? He's a perimeter. He's a perimeter big man. He's like supposed to be the stretch four, kind of like Memento Core. He's supposed to be like Dirt. And then what Larry Brown said, no, we don't need that. You know, Larry Brown was so traditionally old, and he's like, we already got Rasheed doing that. We want him to play with his back to the basket. This kid is like, I can never play with my back to the basket.
I remember it was a game,
and Darko, he pulls up, and he shoots a jumper at three. It may have been a three-point. He shoots a jumper. It was like in the fourth quarter. I remember it like it was like yesterday. It was in the fourth quarter. Pistons were like blowing some team up by 20 points or whatever. And it was like 7 minutes, and after Darko comes in the game. Darko comes in, and he shoots two jumpers. He makes one, and he misses another. Larry Brown pulls him out the game. I said, Larry Brown pulled him out the game because he shot jumpers. And he wanted him to play with his back to the back. That's what I'm trying to say. And this is an 18-year-old kid. Like, this is because he's 7 foot 250 doesn't make him a man. That makes him physically develop.
Okay,
he's
so
a kid.
I'm going to get up Darko real quick, and I'm going to get on Larry Brown right now. Larry Brown was so fucking bad, dude. Oh, my God. I remember one time. God, and like you said about this Darko moment, like, I don't remember that Darko moment, but I remember this moment very vividly about Larry Brown, was that it was a primetime game. I know it was like the Miami Heat, like Dwayne Wade Shaq type of deal, and like it was like on ABC, you know, Sunday afternoon game, Detroit Pistons. I mean, like, 05, like, we were just coming off the championship. I know that because I know this one specific player was not on the championship team, but he was part of the repeat team, or the attempting repeat team. And that guy was my man, Carlos Arroyo. Dude, okay, so everything about Carlos Arroyo screamed, like, flashy street ball player, right? And like, you know damn well fucking Larry Brown doesn't really go for that. Well, what was funny about this moment was that I remember Chauncey getting a blow, and Carlos coming in, he went in to get some PT, and I remember bringing the ball up the court, and there goes Carlos Rowe getting a little fancy with the ball, right? He threw a nice little pass to Rip Hamilton out on the perimeter, but the problem was that Rip Hamilton did not see it, so he ran past the ball, and immediately fucking Larry Brown pointed at fucking Carlos Rowe and was like, get out of here. big, like, he pointed at him, and he put his thumb behind him, like, you out now. Like, I remember that specifically, because I'm like, damn, I mean, he was literally on the court for, like, a minute. Like, he hadn't even been on the court for two possessions, and he immediately yanked Arroyo off the court. It was like, not in my house. Get off the court. It was like the slickest pass, though. He was like behind the legs. It was like a streamlined pass right to Rip. Rip did not see it coming. Like, Rip was too busy jogging up the court to even see the pass coming. And it was pretty funny. It was really funny because I'm like, oh man, I really want to see Arroyo go work. And here comes Chauncey.
I like Carlos Arroyo. I did like Carlos Arroyo.
I think I liked him too, man. He brought a little flavor to the game. But like, it's like, hey, you know what? I was listening to a Chauncey Billups interview recently. And Chauncey's got some really good interviews on YouTube. If you go look him up on YouTube, like, he's like, now that he's retired, he's like kind of like doing these little inside scoop interviews of his career or whatever. And like, he has some really interesting stories about Larry Brown. And what was funny is that he said he had one game that, I mean, like, he was tearing it up. Like, he felt like he was playing, like, the best game of his career. And, like, from the numbers he pointed out, I mean, like, he damn near almost had a triple-double. I mean, really efficient shooting night as well. And he said the Pistons went in the locker room. They won by, like, 15 points or some bullshit like that. And they were going to the locker room celebrating, and Larry Brown's over here shaking his head. I mean, he looks back at Larry Brown, and Larry Brown just starts shaking his head, and he's like, what's going on? And Larry Brown told him something along the lines of, like, he's like, you can't play point guard for my team. He's like, this is not how I want you to play point guard. He's like, the way that you play point guard was just, it's not acceptable, or something like that. Like, Jesus Christ. Larry Brown for you, though. Larry Brown.
Yeah. as a human being, Larry Brown is something else. Only a few people could really tolerate him, but.
Surprisingly, Allen Iverson's one of them.
Yeah.
Do you remember when he got ejected? There was a game when he got ejected mistakenly. The refs threw him out by accident. But they were like, and Larry Brown left the court, and he's like, fine, whatever, I'm leaving. And then, like, they were like, no, we made a mistake, come back. He's like, what, you, I'm gone. No, I'm gone. I don't know, I remember that. I was just like, wow, he just stopped. That was amazing. I was just like, oh, he's got a lot of attitude. I like that. But I think when you think about Chauncey and Rashid and Tayshaun and Rip, the weird thing about it, you barely remember that there were Pistons. You just remember that, how tight they were.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they were so freaking tight. And I remember, okay, like, I'm listening from the periphery. I'm not really a Pistons fan yet. I'm just listening. But I remember four of them went to the All-Star game, and one of them couldn't go or didn't go or wasn't allowed in or whatever. And they wore, like, black bands. Oh, it was Prince. They wore, like, black bands around their arms at the All-Star game because to protest or to say that they missed him or something. Like, you guys are extremely tight. And even when Chauncey came back and was playing, I think, or somebody was playing, I don't know, it wasn't Rip, I forgot. They brought somebody back. I guess it was Chauncey, but Ben Wallace actually came to the Palace. He was sitting here. I was like, you guys are still tight, really? I mean, that's great, but, like, you're really tight. I mean, you're really tight. And I could see, I mean, if you think about Tayshaun compared to Greg Monroe, I mean, it's the same, almost the same type of career, except there's no championships. Like, Greg Monroe is like, I'd like to keep him here if we could, like, help him achieve that. But it seems like it will just be more resentment, this building. Yeah. And I'm like, let him go. And I hope he does well with Milwaukee or whatever, but I don't know. Like, Tayshaun, I'm like, please don't tell me he went to Cleveland, though.
I don't know. Hey, guys, I'm going to have to wrap it up.
Okay. Who's this?
Song.
This Elder.
Sounds good, man. It was fun.
This is the longest one we've ever had.
Yeah, this was.
I know, this was a good one. If I didn't have to go, I would still be on here.
This was a good one. This was a good one. I didn't bring up the topic I wanted to, but I don't know. I think we'll say
we're going to work on staying on topic.
We're going to work on it. I think, What do you think? Do you think that we had too many people on? Because it felt like people were leaving because we had too many people talking.
Yeah, we'll work on it. I think that there's something in the system. We'll work on it and see how we can do that. Do the part where get people kind of talking a little bit more, or kind of where you can set it up. Maybe you gotta find something in the system. We'll find something.
All right, because
early.
Yeah, because I like what we got going on. It's just that I feel like I think we had too many people talking at one time, at one point, like very early on, and then people just kind of left.
Yeah, we'll work out the details. Maybe have to make it more like it'd be cool if we could turn it into, we'll talk about it, but I could do that, go like a call-in type of thing. I think that'd be real cool.
Right.
Oh, like a radio show?
Yeah, kind of like make it that way, like find a way to get people to chime in or to call in and, you know, kind of do it that way. And so that everybody can have a chance to really talk, you know, give everybody a chance to talk, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I like it.
We're looking for it. We'll see how flexible this system is and see what this system can do.
All right.
What do you think?
All right, guys.
What do you think about, do you know of any other systems like this one?
I'll look into it. I got somebody who knows all these little technical stuff, so I'll see what they say and see if they can find some out for us.
All right, man. Sounds good.
All right, good show.
Next week.
Absolutely, right. Man. Sounds good, bro.
All right,
man.
We'll
condense our topics next week, too.
We'll do that. Man. All right, guys.
All right.
Take it easy.
Bye.
Bye.